Live from Goggin Ice Center here at Steve Cady Arena, the Miami RedHawks look to avenge their last night's loss against the Denver Pioneers. Hello, everyone, and welcome to RedHawk Radio. We'll have coverage of the Miami RedHawks versus the Denver Pioneers coming up shortly, but now the pregame show. Obviously, looking back at last night, a night to forget for the RedHawks as they lost that game 4-0 against the third-ranked Denver Pioneers. Of course, this is a Pioneers team coming in straight off their national championship run in which they won 5-1 in the national championship last year. Just a dominant run towards that Frozen Four and eventually bringing home the title to Denver. This is a highly powerful team that's got a lot of draft picks on their squad, and they're looking to sweep this series to open up NCHC play against the RedHawks here at Goggin Ice Center. Looking at last night's meeting, obviously not the ideal game for Miami. They had Mazur had three goals and Braz had the fourth. Connor Mazur, of course, coming into this one, 8 goals, 10 assists, and they've got some really good players for Denver on their side. Casey Dornbach, one of those guys as well, comes in with 3 goals, 8 assists on the year, and Massimo Rizzo with 2 goals and 8 assists. Obviously, you don't have a good team like Denver without having a goon in the goal, and that's Magnus Corona. He's logged already this year through seven games, 350 minutes. You heard that correct, 350 minutes for Corona, just an absolute workhorse in the goal for the Pioneers. He's got 11 goals allowed and 128 saves. He had 24 saves last night. Looking at deeper in the numbers, last night we saw the Pioneers outshoot Miami 37-24. They also had 7 minutes and 55 seconds in the power play as well. Now looking towards the Miami side from last night, one takeaway was that they did win 33-27 in the faceoff category, and they had 5 penalties for 21 minutes combined. So obviously less than impressive there from Miami for the penalties, but nonetheless, it was still a good game in terms of the faceoff. Obviously, looking towards the Miami side, it's been the usual suspects like Red Savage with 2 goals and 4 assists. Joe Cassetti also has 4 goals, 3 assists on the year, and Matt Barbolini coming in with 3 goals, 4 assists as well. The Miami RedHawks looking to score the first goal of this series tonight and hopefully pick up a win to avenge that loss from last year. Like we said, we can't talk about a good team without having a good goalie, and that's Ludvig Pearson for the RedHawks coming into this one, having a great, great year thus far. And altogether, he's looking to keep that streak going against the Pioneers as well. Looking at this whole series, obviously this is kind of a growing rivalry between the RedHawks and the Pioneers, but the Pioneers do lead the series 26-13-3. So they're looking to improve to 27 wins on the series against the RedHawks tonight. Obviously, this is the opening NCHC series of the year. They're the only in-conference opponent for the NCHC thus far. Like we said, RedHawks looking to get off the schneid against Denver to open up this series with another win here at Goggin Ice Center. We'll be back with scoreboard segment on the RedHawk Radio pregame show just after this. And we're back here on Red Hawk Radio. Time for our scoreboard segment looking across college hockey. We see right now tied up at one after the first period, Canisius and Sacred Heart. Obviously, Canisius, a team that Miami played earlier this year. So a somewhat similar opponent there. They're taking on Sacred Heart this weekend, and they've got a 1-1 score there. Holy Cross takes on RIT later, and Mercyhurst and Niagara clash as well in that conference. Bowling Green, Minnesota State taking each other on in the CCHA, along with Ferris State and St. Thomas taking each other on. That both those games will be at 6:07 Central Time, and excuse me, St. Thomas Ferris State will be actually at 6:00 Eastern Time. And the ECAC Union and Rensselaer will take each other on at 7:00, and Yale and Brown also taking each other on at 7:00. At 8:00, Princeton and Harvard will be clashing there. Hockey East, UMass Lowell, one of the opponents of the Miami RedHawks at this point this year, will take on Boston University. Northeastern will take on Maine. Massachusetts and Merrimack will meet, and New Hampshire and Providence will find each other in what should be a close game in Hockey East. Like we mentioned, Denver-Miami, the only NCHC in-conference game this weekend, and that should be a good one. We'll have that at 5:05 Eastern Time here on Red Hawk Radio. The Big Ten, a couple big clashes between the Ohio State Buckeyes and the Minnesota Golden Gophers. That one will come on in just a second. They're tied up at nothing at the beginning of the game there. Notre Dame and Michigan State taking each other on at 6:00. That one should be a good one in the Big Ten as well. And Penn State and Wisconsin at 7:00 Central Time. That will be the final game in conference for the Big Ten. And then for now, all of our non-conference opponent, Vermont and Colgate. Vermont is leading that game 1-0 in the second period against Colgate. Lindenwood and Bentley matched up in a good one there. 2-1 the score. Bentley on top right now. St. Lawrence taking on Michigan Tech at 6:00 Eastern Time. That should be a good one as well. Alaska and Northern Michigan at 6:00. Also another good matchup. Northern Michigan coming into that one 4-5, and Alaska coming in at 4-4-1. That should be an exciting matchup between those two teams. Cornell and Minnesota Duluth set to take each other on. Cornell coming into this one, 0 wins, 0 losses, 0 ties. Minnesota Duluth coming into that one with two wins, 4 losses, and no ties. So Minnesota Duluth looking to build up some momentum again in their season against Cornell tonight. Omaha taking on Long Island. That game will drop the puck at 7:00 Eastern Time. Clarkson Lake Superior also a 7:00 puck drop. Clarkson coming into that one, 1 win, 4 losses, and Lake Superior coming in 0 wins, 3 losses, and 1 tie. Lake Superior looking to pick up the inaugural win of the 2022-2023 campaign. Colorado College taking on Air Force. That one should be a good one. Colorado College comes in 2-4-0, and then Air Force coming in 2-3-1 in that one, so should be a good matchup there. And Arizona State taking on North Dakota. Arizona State at 4-4, North Dakota at 3-2-1. That one will be a 9:00 Pacific time puck drop. That should be a fun game to watch there. And Michigan against Western Michigan. That game going to be at 6:00 Eastern Time. Western Michigan coming into that one 5-2. Michigan coming in at 5-1. Two Michigan teams clashing in that one. That should be a fun game to watch as well. And that'll round out our scoreboard segment here on Red Hawk Radio. We'll bring in Luke West Poley to talk this game between the Red Hawks and the Pioneers just next here on Parents Weekend from Gog and Ice Center. We'll be back on Red Hawk Radio in just a moment. And we're back here from Goggin Ice Center. We now are joined alongside by Luke Westpoley. And Luke, this game's going to be pretty good. Miami obviously coming off a tough loss last night against the Pioneers of Denver. What do the RedHawks need to do to get back off that schneid? Obviously, they've had some big wins this year. They've had some tough losses. They went to UMass Lowell, picked up a big win. Kind of teetering, kind of along. Are we good? Are we not? How do the RedHawks solidify that they're a good team and pick up a much-needed home win today here against the highly powered third-ranked Denver Pioneers?
I think you just got to compete, and I think that all starts with the first period. I think that the RedHawks have kind of played a lot of games this year where they've come out with a different level of energy in every single period. We certainly saw that in the opening home series against Ferris State, and I think that's been the case also as the RedHawks have taken to the road the past couple of weekends in the series against Canisius and UMass Lowell. I think it just comes down to playing three competitive periods of hockey against a Denver team that you look up and down their lineup and you don't find very many weaknesses for this team. I mean, they're so good. They won the national championship last year. It's no secret that this Denver program is one of the most prolific in the country, and so it really takes three good periods to beat a team like that. And I think for Miami, you're just going to want to play a competitive game. We knew this was going to be a measuring stick series for the team moving forward as they got into this series against the best team they've played all year. And I think you just got to play competitive games and win or lose to have something to hang your hat on there.
Yeah, and I think being competitive is a great point you make, because realistically, you look at top to bottom, this roster from Denver, it's a better roster than Miami has. Yep. This is a team riddled with draft picks in the NHL, guys that are looking to play on the next level after their time at Denver is up. Denver's got a great coach in Coach Carl, got a well over 500 record on his tenure with Denver. But you mentioned a great point. You can play any of these games competitive, especially in the NCHC. Looking at this roster from Miami, you got guys like Red Savage, PJ Fletcher. Who do you like to step up in a big game like this and bring that competitive edge against a big team like Denver?
Well, it's going to have to be that top line, right? You mentioned some of those guys already, Red Savage, PJ Fletcher, and Matthew Barbolini going to play on the left wing alongside those two guys on the top line tonight for the RedHawks. That line offensively has been good for Miami. All three of those guys are very offensively gifted. We've seen that in years past, but they got to find the scoreboard. The RedHawks were not able to beat Magnus Crona last night. Got a pretty good amount of shots on goal. They were heavily outshot, but still 20-plus shots. You need to be scoring at least two goals probably if you're looking at beating a team like Denver off that shot total, and I expect that line to really get going. I think you also got to look to that second line as well, and most specifically Joe Cassetti. Thought he had a solid game yesterday, and Max Dukovac's been one of the really, really offensively talented freshmen that has come in and made an impact for Miami. I think those five guys offensively are going to have to be good, and Ludvig Pearson, as always, the RedHawks lean on him so much, but they're going to have to continue to do so against a really, really good Denver team again tonight.
Yeah, and you mentioned Magnus Crona. Obviously had a great night last night, didn't allow a goal. The Sharks pick from a few years ago. What do you like about Corona? Obviously, we saw him earlier in pregame just getting locked in, looking at the goal as shots were flying around. I mean, what really separates this guy from some of the rest of the goalies in the league? Is it preparation? What do you think really boils down there?
I mean, he's a veteran goalie. He's a senior now. You mentioned he's a draft pick from the San Jose Sharks back in 2018, but I really think that he just commands the crease well. He's a really big goalie at 6'5", 215. That's about as big as they come, and I think he really just stands solid in the Denver net. He's a guy that brings a tremendous amount of experience. We talked about he is a senior. He backstopped them to a national championship last year, and he's a guy that's just going to bring really solid performances on you night in, night out. That's the thing about big goalies. You're not going to beat them on clear shots. He's going to come out on you, stand at the top of his crease, and if you're going to try to shoot on him and beat him one-on-one, he's basically going to save every shot you throw his way. So for the RedHawks, if you look their way, it's going to have to be a lot of stuff across the ice. You're going to have to get him moving back and forth. That can be tougher for some of those big goalies, and you're really going to want to pull him off his line to try and beat him, because those clear shots that Miami was taking yesterday clearly are not going to work against a goalie as big as he is. But Magnus Crona is one of the best in the entire nation. He's a guy that may be up for the Richter Award at the end of the year when things are all said and done. You look at his career stat line, and it speaks for himself. A .914 save percentage over a career is very, very impressive, especially at a school like Denver that plays the schedule that they do. He's a really good goalie, but Miami's got to figure out some way to solve him tonight.
Yeah, Magnus Crona coming into this game, 1.88 goals allowed average. He's got a 2.18 goals allowed average in his career. But we mentioned earlier, Ludvig Pearson coming into this one, got a great goals allowed average at 213 this year, and he's got a career one of 3.32. What do you like about Pearson in the goal? Obviously, we talked about Corona, how he's so dominant one-on-one in his schemes against the crease. What do you like about Pearson, and how does he limit some of those goals that we saw scored last night?
Pearson's such a calm presence in the Miami net. He really is, and he's a guy that has just gotten pounded every single year that he's been in the Miami net. You look at the 3.32 goals against from his entire career, and it doesn't look that impressive, but we talked about it on some earlier broadcasts. You look at how many shots he's had to face, and you kind of realize why the goals against is so high. He's got a .930 save percentage on the year this season. That is tremendous. That's really, really impressive. He's just a great backstop for Miami in that he makes a couple of really key saves every game, and you really see it where he'll make a couple of really great A stops that allow him to keep his team in the game. Miami continues to lean on him heavily. He faced over 40 shots last night, and he may have to do so again today. Ludvig's going to have a good night as always. Chris Bergeron has kind of come to expect those really strong performances from Pearson night in and night out, almost superhuman level performances from him, but he's been up to the task all season long, and I expect tonight to be no different.
Yeah, Pearson coming in this one, he's going to have a tough night ahead of him, especially when we look at this front line from Denver. Got Rizzo, Mazur, and Dornbach. Those guys combined for a monster night last night. Obviously, we saw Mazur get the hat trick, had three of them, Rizzo, Dornbach, and those guys really combined for the assist in that one. What do you like? I mean, obviously, there's a lot to like about this front line for Denver, but how do you limit their production? Because obviously, it just seems like with those big names, they're going to get theirs. How do you limit the overall production of the team?
They're so prolific. In that top line, you mentioned it, those three guys after the hat trick last night. Carter Mazur, he's tied for the nation's lead in goals with 8 in 7 games, which is absolutely wild to think about. You look at the other two guys on that line, they're top 5 in the country in assists. You look at Casey Dornbach and Massimo Rizzo, they're both tied for 3rd in the country with 8 assists each through the opening 7 games. I mean, those guys are just so, so good. And for the RedHawks, of course, you're going to want to limit them. But you really, I think, just want to see what the potential is of these other lines. You're going to want to play your top defensive pairing against that prolific first line, but we really haven't gotten to see as much of that offensive prowess from the second, third, and fourth lines for Denver offensively, and I think you're going to want to get those guys out on the ice as much as you can. You really just got to try to shut down that top line, try to frustrate them, and really make David Carl start to run his lines and get into some of those lower areas on the depth chart.
Yeah, and obviously forcing the front line out of there is going to be a big thing, but you really don't get much drop-off from the second line.
Nope.
You got guys like Rieger Lorenz, Braz, who had a goal last night, and Devine. All three of those guys also draft picks, so there's really not much drop-off from Denver, but obviously you want to get those top three, kind of limit their production tonight and see what you can't do against the bottom three, and then keep moving on down the lines and make Coach Carl move those guys around. Now let's talk some defense. Obviously, this is a Denver team. They're talented across the board. They got a good goalkeeper, great lines on offense, and then they've got some great defensemen like Behrens. And just looking across the board, I mean, these guys are just a powerhouse. Who do you like from Denver's defense, and how do Miami attack them tonight to try to get some goals on the board?
I look at the two captains. They have their main captain, Justin Lee, and then the alternate, Kyle Mayhew, who's going to play on the right side on the first pairing for Denver. But what I really like the most, I don't think, isn't even necessarily an individual on Denver's roster in terms of their defense. Denver has just always been a team. This dates back to their former head coach in Jim Montgomery, who won a national championship with them before moving on to the NHL ranks. Of course, he now coaches the Boston Bruins in the National Hockey League. But they are so, so disciplined defensively. They're not a team that makes mistakes. They will sit back and they will let you do your thing, but they're really not going to let you get any type of penetration inside. And they're just a really, really solid group defensively that plays really disciplined hockey, and it's very mistake-free. It's really a wonder that they've been able to sustain it for this long, but I just love how deep this Denver team is on defense and how smart they are as a 7-man unit.
Yeah, and they're a great defensive unit, but let's turn to the RedHawks of Miami. They've got a couple good defensemen as well. Jack Clement, the captain, obviously, he's leading this squad. Who do you like from the Miami side on defense?
Yeah, I think I like Jack Clement. He's playing up there on the right side on that opening pairing. And you look down to that second pairing as well. You got a couple of guys in Nick Donato and Hampus Rehquist. Rehquist got ejected yesterday. Lucky for him, he dodged the DQ and only got the game misconduct. And so he is eligible to be back in the lineup for tonight, and he will play. But I think for Miami, they're going to have a tough task ahead of them, and it's really going to have to be all three defensive lines and that extra defenseman who today is Axel Kublin, making his fourth appearance out of Stockholm, Sweden. Those seven guys are going to have a tall order, but they're going to have to do their best rotating all the way through against a really deep and prolific Denver scoring unit.
Well, there you have it, folks. That's just about the breakdown for tonight's matchup in the NCHC between the Miami RedHawks and the Denver Pioneers. We'll send it to break, and we'll be just about set for Miami RedHawk hockey action.
All right, we welcome you to Steve Coach Cady Arena at the Goggin Ice Center here tonight. It's game two of this pivotal conference series between the Miami RedHawks and the Denver Pioneers. We'll see what the RedHawks can do after falling 4-0 on the sheet last night. They were shut out at home in their first league game of the season. Patrick Geshan, Luke West, Poley with you high above the ice. We heard Luke, you and Zach Rengers talking on the pregame show about how important of a game this is for the RedHawks, and they're facing a team that, you know, it's really hard to try to build some momentum against in the Denver Pioneers, the third-ranked team in the nation. Denver's starting lineup being announced right now, but overall for Miami, the energy's got to be better, the fight's got to be better, and the communication on the ice has got to be better, as all of those things weren't really there last night when they needed to be for Miami.
Yeah, and I think the most frustrating thing for Chris Bergeron and his staff has got to be that it's been a different team coming out seemingly in every single period. We don't know what kind of response we're going to get from a Miami team at any given time. They'll come out of the locker room. It almost seems like it's predetermined. And yep. So I think that, like you said, Patrick, it's going to need to be better tonight. But I think that sustainability is going to be something that Miami really needs to build moving forward, getting into the league. You got to play three good periods in this league, or else you're not going to win too many hockey games. I don't know if they played any really good periods necessarily last night, but you're going to need three more than that here today if you're going to want to even compete with a Denver team that's one of the best in the country.
You could argue the first period was close last night, but number two and number three were definitely not where they have to be for this team to compete in this league this season. RedHawks starting lineup being announced right now. We have a little bit of delayed start. It was parents' weekend here this weekend. They did all the ceremonies before the game where the parents came out on the ice and they were introduced with their respective players, so that's going to set our faceoff back here by about 5 or 6 minutes past where it should have been at 5:05 Eastern time. But we know the storylines. We know what the RedHawks need to do to get a win. Let's join Scott Schreiber in the public address here inside Steve Cady Arena. The RedHawks starting lineup being wrapped up, and they'll have the national anthem from the band. Stay with us. job, as always, by the Miami Hockey Band. We got an okay student section here on a Saturday based on Halloween weekend, so that's a plus. And the general admittance crowd filling in finally as well before this 5 o'clock, or 5:10 now, puck drop between Miami and Denver. Starting goaltenders for tonight, Magnus Crona gets it for the Pioneers. Will make his sixth straight start of the year, 4-2-0 on the season, 1.88 goals against, .921 save percentage. He got his first shutout of the year last night, of course, and 10 shutouts in the career for Magnus Crona. It is the 25th straight start in the Red Hawk net for Ludvig Pearson, junior from Hinda, Sweden, will make his eighth start of the year, 4-2-1 record, 2.13 goals against, save percentage this year, a whopping 9.30 for Ludvig Pearson. Same uniforms as last night for each team. Denver is in their road maroons with the tan name, tan number on the back. Denver's across the front with a number in tan as well on the front of the uniform. They get maroon helmets as well. Red Hawks are in the home whites with the red M on the front. Red name, red number on the back. The white helmets tonight for Miami. Referees, Nick Kresbach and Nathan Wheeler. Eric Frank and Nick Huff work the lines. Eric Frank, the mayor of Indianapolis, will drop the puck to start the game. Red Hawks move right to left across your radio, period number one. And Luke's big start is going to be huge for Miami.
Absolutely. Got to start fast. Need that energy right off the jump. Denver's a team that can really pound you early on, so you need to have that energy right from the drop of the puck.
The game is on from Oxford. Red Hawks control the opening draw in their own zone. Dylan Moulton and Jack Clement are a deep pair here tonight. Moulton swings the puck at the left wing. Barbalini chips it near corner of the Pioneer zone, and it goes behind the Denver net. Barbalini first two at the far corner, trying to slide a pass through Rizzo, and didn't quite work. Works it up to the right point. Clement, soft wrister in, and a good save by Crona with a left pad. He'll cover up the rebound as we get the stoppage 24 seconds into the opening period. 4-0, of course, was the score last night, thanks to a Carter, Missouri natural hat trick for Denver. And the Pioneers team was just rolling all night long. Missouri, their leading scorer this year, 8 goals already on the season, Luke.
Yep, leading the nation right now, tied for first with those 8 goals in just 7 games. That's just a truly ridiculous stat line, over a goal per game this early on in the season.
First natural hat trick in over a decade for Denver as well. He scored last night. Pioneers win the drop, first circle their own zone, work it back in the Miami end, and it pops out back to center, and Denver will control their own way. Rose feeds left wing, Devine over the Red Hawk line in the far corner of Miami zone. Donato will shovel a pass around the boards near half wall to Dukovac. He missed it. Denver ends up with a puck. We'll set up here in the offensive end. Barron's turned it over, though, back to Dukovac. Works its way into the neutral zone. Picked up center circle here by Waldron. Over the Pioneer line right wing, Reichquist a shot. In the far circle, got a feed. Nice shoulder save. The right side of the body of Crona made it. Barron's trying to fling this one out to center. He could not. Red Hawks good forecheck. Far wing of the offensive zone. Cassetti dumps it deep in the Denver end, and the Pioneers will break out here. Kyle Mayhew through center ice over the Red Hawk line of the right wing to the near corner. Will circle back, try to feed near circle. Bros had it in his skates. Red Hawks charge up the ice. Ryan Savage fires it over the Pioneer line of the right wing. Taranski far corner trying to get a centering pass through. The attempt blocked down by Rieger Lorenz, the reigning NCHC Rookie of the Week. Kyle Mayhew behind the Denver net with a puck. A little over 90 seconds into the game, no score between the Red Hawks and the Pioneers. Right wing feed Devine, rink wide to center. Drazner's going to pick it up for the Red Hawks as Denver is in a change. Near wing Murray, left side of center ice. Taranski pops it over the Pioneer line, left wing in a reverse direction. The puck from a Pioneer player that sends it up the right wing of the Red Hawks zone. Wright picks it up, far circle, trying to center it ahead. Ends up at the right point. Shai Buiam is on it, spins it around the boards to the near corner, picked up by the Pioneer there. Those Ozar near side, he coughed it up. And Blake Messenberg will fire this one back out to center for Miami. It ends up in behind the Denver net. Crona behind his net to play it, turns it over, spun it around the far boards. Reichquist picked it off. Dylan Moulton trying to send it forward from the left point. He could not. Pops its way back out to the neutral zone. Red Hawks send it all the way up the ice. This will be no icing, as it was a feed ahead by Red Hawk up the right wing that got tipped at center ice. Buiam picks it up for Denver, fires over the Red Hawk line right side, and behind the Denver net, or the Red Hawk net rather. Denver picks it up. Here is Edwards, gets it center blue line, bending a drive, rebound loose in the crease. They're trying to dig at it. Red Hawks get the rebound as it was Red Savage swooping in to pick it up. Far corner goes Clement, up the wing for Barbalini, back to the neutral zone. Pioneers take over on a loose puck there, grabbed by Brett Edwards, works it up the far wing by the benches. Beats Capone over the Red Hawk line here in the left wing. Dances to the half wall, slams on the brakes, fires the puck back around the boards and behind the net, where it's grabbed there by Tristan Lemire. Feeds it up to the left point, and with it there's Lee. Far circle, Mazur. The dangerous stick of Mazur drives to the net. It popped off the backhand back out to center ice. Pioneers pick it up right wing. Lee will send it around the boards hard to the far side of the Red Hawk zone. Cassini trying to work it out from there. Get some help from Rehnquist. Puck turned over to Mazur for a moment, and then Rehnquist trying to clear it up the far wing. It's kept in left point. Barron's a shot. Nice right pad saved by Pearson on the snapper. Puck carries its way far half wall after the rebound, and Donato grabs it for the Red Hawks. Sends a feed to the far corner for Rehnquist. He coughed it up, though. Couldn't calm down the bouncing puck. Rizzo on it. Far circle. Bouncing puck again, and a shot wide to the near side of the net by Dornbach. Denver still here in the offensive zone. Red Hawks able to tip a pass back out to center. Dukovac grabs it over the Pioneer line to the right wing. Lost it down to the far corner. Great defensive play by Mazur coming from behind to shut down Dukovac there, and the Pioneers controlling their own zone. Samuel Rizzo through center ice over the Red Hawk line of the right wing. Dances his way to the net up the near side to the near post. Puck popped off the backhand. Nobody really got a stick on it there, and a Red Hawk stick will clear it back in the Denver zone. 15:35 to go in the opening period. No score, Miami at Denver. The shots even at two apiece. Over the line of the right wing in the Miami zone. Here's Bros with a shot on the off wing. It popped up high on Pearson. The rebound off his chest in front of him in the blue paint. He will cover it up as Bros drove through the near circle and will get the stoppage here with 15:27 to go in the opening period. We had a lot of this last night as well. Stretches of 4, 5, 6 minutes without a whistle. And happening again.
Yeah, and that top line for Denver really doing it all. You saw Carter Mazur generate some scoring chances and then go back into NIMAX Dukovac. They can do it on both ends. And it's going to be tough for Miami on both sides of the puck.
He saw it to the left of Pearson, one by Denver. They get a quick shot on net, deflected to the near corner, picked up there by Bros. Works it up left point. Bouncing puck can be grabbed there by Lucas Ulvestad in the lineup tonight for Denver. And the Pioneers will ice it here up the right wing as Bowiem trying to feed a pass to the offensive zone. He was a step or two behind the center ice red line on the right wing, and the draw will come on the icing call against Denver to the right of Crona with 15:10 to go in period number one. The shots 4-2 Denver in a scoreless game.
I think the energy's been pretty good for Miami, but I think Denver's playing it pretty well defensively. They're letting Miami take these shots from the perimeter, and they're easy saves right now for Crona.
Offensive zone time for the Red Hawks. Bessenberg picked up the faceoff win, sent it wide of the net on the far side. Puck pops out back to center. Pioneers over the Red Hawk line left wing. Bros cycles it off the far half wall. Devine left point. Lee off the bench. Shoots it top of the far circle right to the breadbasket of Pearson, who makes the stop on its snapper. And we'll get our first media timeout of the game with 14:53 to go in period number one. No score, Miami at Denver. Pioneers lead the shots 5-2. We're back in a moment. This is Miami Hockey on Red Hawk Radio. .14:53 to go in the opening period. Miami and Denver are scoreless. Patrick Geshan, Luke West pulling back with you high above the ice. It's Steve Cady Arena. Zach Rengers with us as well as the series finale between Miami and Denver underway here from Oxford. Luke, your thoughts so far? Red Hawks, Pioneers pretty even in the first 5 minutes of the game, but still pretty even, still early, I should say, so far in the first.
Yeah, I think the energy on both sides has been good. That's been evident with the speed of the game. It's been exceptionally high so far, but it's kind of in that stage where we're yet to see a team really make a mistake. I think that's going to happen at some point given how fast this game has been paced. But both teams just kind of feeling each other out right now.
Ludwig Pearson has the Dorados right in the Red Hawks zone. Miami banks it off the boards back to center ice. After the faceoff win, Piners quickly back to the offensive end. Donato gets the puck for the Red Hawks near corner, sends it up the boards. Ozar plays it middle. Here's Rehquist through center ice, chips over the Piner line, left wing and behind the Denver net. Lee first to it, swings it around the boards to the far half wall. Donato chips it in behind the Piner cage. Benning plays it up to the left point, kept in there by Rehquist. Where the Red Hawks work it free near half wall. Ryan Savage, chance near circle with a shot. Krona got the glove on it. The bouncing puck in front is lifted out to center ice by the Pioneers. Lee did that to get it out of danger. The best chance Miami's had offensively all day.
That was a really good save by Krona to stay with Ryan Savage, too, after he made the little hesitation move. Made the save with the glove.
Yep. Behrens plays it near corner. Lemire gets hit by Caragiallo. To the near corner now for Denver. Capone trying to lift up the near wing. He does get it back to center. Moulton cannot keep it in for the Red Hawks. Dylan Moulton back in his own zone. Returning to action this weekend after he got injured at UMass Lowell a few weekends ago in the Friday night game. Here's Clement. Skates it through the neutral zone near wing. Dumps it in over the Piner line left side. Mayhew off glass. Can't quite get it out. Daskis comes into the near corner to charge his way to the far side. Puck squirts up the far boards. Red Hawks with it. It popped up in the air. They'll get a hand pass call as a Red Hawk, I believe, moved that with his hand. Caragiallo's in the area, so was Miami's Blake Messenberg on defense. And the hand pass call against the Red Hawks puts it around the neutral zone on the Denver left wing, closest to their blue line. 13:22 to go in the first. Scoreless in the first period of play. This is the only NCHC League Series going on this weekend. So the first league game of the year was played here last night.
A lot of interesting non-conference games being played around the league too this weekend.
Kyle Mayhew picks it up near corner for Denver. A lot of good matchups. Barbellini turned it over to the offensive zone, trying to play it middle. Mazur picked it off, feeds it up toward Rizzo up the right wing. Could not connect with him. Came in on Pearson. Rizzo stole it away off the near post. Feeds the line, right point, but Williams on it for Denver. Dances toward the middle, a slap shot there, and Ludwig gloves it down on the near wing. He had no traffic to deal with. A routine save for Pearson. And the clock stopped with 12:59 to go in period number one, and a scoreless game.
Yeah, going back to our conversation earlier, Patrick, here's some interesting matchups. Arizona State playing North Dakota and Vegas today. They got the Michigan, Western Michigan series that got canceled last year. That was a big controversy when that happened. And so those teams will actually get to play this year.
Redhawks ice the puck near circle their own zone to stop the clock. 12:52 to go in the first. Faceoff one spun around the boards and went all the way down the ice.
Cornell taking on Duluth to kick off their season. Cornell, a solid team out of the ECAC. That's going to be a tough test for Duluth, who's really struggled to start their year. They've been probably one of the bigger disappointments if you look at NCHC teams and how they started their year. But Derek Dashke did have the game winner last night.
That's good. Set some big goals for him this year.
Both goals for him this season have been game winners. One came in overtime. Last night's was not in overtime. But
making an impact. Denver with a puck near the neutral zone after the faceoff in the Red Hawk end. Dornbach right wing plays it to Rizzo of the Red Hawk line. That never really quite worked on the rush. Dornbach back with it at center ice. Feeds behind him for the new defenseman tonight in Lucas Oldestad to turn it over. Fletcher over the Piner line right wing. Feeds Rhett Savage down the middle. He never got a shot off there. Good defense as it popped in on Krona, who made the save against his left pad. Bowiem came behind Rhett Savage, kind of knocked a stick check there just as Red was thinking about shooting it. Kind of came off his stick right to Krona. Easy save for Magnus to make. 12:21 to go in the opening period. Offensive zone drop coming up for the Red Hawks.
Yeah, really good play there from Bowiem. Looked like Ryan Savage was going to try to cut that one back across the net to try and get Magnus Krona to move, and it was just that little stick check from Bowiem that did not allow Savage to do that. That just trickled harmlessly in on Krona, where he was able to cover.
Sending the draw for the Red Hawks with Jack Devine. Clean win near corner. Piners work it all the way down the ice off the stick of Benning, who's just trying to get it out and went too hard for the icing call. And the draw will come here down at Krona's end to his left. 12:15 to go in period number one of the game.
I think Miami's forecheck's been pretty good so far on Denver. They're not normally a team that turns the puck over as much as they have, I think, through the early goings deep in their end. But I think the Miami forecheck's done a good job. They've been able to establish some zone time because of that.
And it was last night in the first, but once you got second, third period, it was a different story.
Forechecking takes a lot of energy, and that's kind of the big thing for Miami right now.
Back in the Denver zone, Lee picks it up off Corona stick, feeds near circle, worked up the right wing for Devine, back to center ice. Here's Lorenz over the Red Hawk line right wing, hands it off, Burrows through the near circle to drive to the net, and he roofed it over the top left corner of Pearson's cage. In behind the net, Axel Kumlin on it for Miami, works it free, Waldron far corner trying to pick up the loose puck. Devine comes in to steal it away, popped in front of Pearson's net. Red Hawks, plenty of personnel there to get it out to safety at center ice. Dukovac over the Pioneer line, right wing through the far circle, messed with by Benning, and a call is coming here against the Pioneers.
Good draw there by Max Dukovac.
Yeah, Dukovac coming down the far wing. Benning was defending him, so was Lorenz in a one against two situation, and Benning a little bit too rough on Dukovac to kind of knock him over away from the puck. An illegal defensive play. They're going to call 2 minutes for holding against Benning, and the first power play of the game goes to Miami with 11 and a half to go in the first.
Dukovac drew a lot of attention down there. Just kept possession of that puck. Three Pioneers came in on him. That was what it took to pry him loose, but that's not a legal play. Miami going to get a power play 0 for 2 last night.
Draw to Corona's right to kick it off. Pioneers win the faceoff, working all the way down the ice off the stick of Mayhew around the boards. Close far corner Red Hawk zone. Miami power play this season, 26.1% conversion rate. Here is Red Savage near circle, dishes back behind the net for Rehquist. Denver penalty kill, that's only 78.3% on the season. Been a little bit of a weakness early on for this Pioneers team. Hawks chipping into the offensive zone with 1:30 left in the power play for the Red Hawks. Left point Fletcher, slides it right point for Rehquist. Down to the far circle for Ryan Savage. Now up right point, here's Fletcher. Walks it down to the far corner, off the boards pass, right point Rehquist. Left point Red Savage, fired it through the slot. Missed his brother Ryan over his stick. Murdoch still in the offensive zone. Red Savage left point, center blue line Rehquist. Winds up for a wrist shot there. They get blocked by the leg of Ozar. Pops to the near half wall, Ryan Savage on it. Give and go with the Red. Center point for Rehquist, far circle, Fletcher a drive, sent it wide to the near side of the net. It caromed off the boards all the way down the ice. On the self-clear by Miami, Rehquist back to get it with 45 to go in the power play. He's behind his own net with fellow Swede Ludvig Pearson. Rehquist dishes back for Taranski. Far side for Waldron up the right wing, rink wide to the left side. Cassetti feeds Taranski over the Pioneer line, left wing to the near corner. He will send this pass off a stick through the end zone, below the goal line, up and out of play. Went off a Denver stick, I believe, with 27 to go on the power play for Miami. 9:56 to go in the first. And the offensive zone drop for the Red Hawks to the right of Corona here.
Yeah, Denver's been really high pressure on this penalty kill, and Miami's struggled a little bit when they can't perfectly set up their power play system to really get settled in the offensive zone.
Yep. Draw to Corona's right, Cassetti wins it back left point, Kumlin to the near half wall, Waldron back to the line, Kumlin turns to Waldron near circle, gets it down near corner for Dukovac, 15 to go on the power play. Lee charges against Dukovac, up against the boards, Waldron picks it up, feeds left point, Kumlin picks it up on the backhand, will shovel it down low in the zone in the near corner. Dukovac near half wall, Waldron back to the line, Kumlin shoots it wide left of the net on the ice, the power play's over, back to 5-on-5. Our circle is the puck here. Red Hawks offensive zone. Moulton let it go. Here comes Benning up the ice out of the box. Over the Red Hawk line, right wing. Dishes over to right. Could never really get a shot off there on the right side of the net. Good stick work made by Waldron, who is back on defense. Pioneers with it, their own zone. Bouncing puck all over the ice. Here's Bro. He's got a feed over the Red Hawk line. Left wing with a shot. Pearson got a piece of it. Went to the far side of his net in behind the cage. Clement gets the pitching wedge out to work into center ice. Messenberg flips it over the Pioneer line on the right wing to the far corner. Karen Giallo to the right point for Donato. Left side, Clement. Far circle, a shot, Karen Giallo. And Corona saw it all the way and made the save with his chest. 8:46 to go in the opening period. Yet an injured Denver player behind the play. That was Tristan Brose. the sophomore from Bloomington, Minnesota. We'll check on him, make sure he's all right with the media timeout here from Oxford. 8:46 to go in the first. No score, Miami and Denver. Miami Hockey on Red Hawk Radio. .46 to go on the first. Miami and Denver are scoreless from Oxford, Ohio in game two of the series. Patrick Getch and Luke West Poley with it high above the ice for Steve Cady Arena. Zach Renner's with us as well. Okay, crowd, Luke, for game two of the series.
Yeah, not bad. 5 o'clock start kind of hampers it a little bit,
I feel. Yeah. Student section is all right. We got a decent amount of general admittance crowd inside the arena. Redhawks offensive zone, draw the timeout. Right winger went to Clement at the point, sends it in behind the Pioneer cage to the far corner. Barbellini back to the line for Clement, fires a wrister in. Was blocked by his own man in front in Red Savage, and the puck pops its way back out to center ice. Barbellini flips it over right wing. Here's Clement. A feed to Red Savage, chips over the Pioneer line to the right side. Here is Mayhew, far corner, Denver zone. Gets it up for Mazur. He lost control. Redhawks messing a little bit with the Denver breakout. Pioneers still work it out back to center ice. Here's Rizzo with the Red Hawk line right wing. Feeds it to Dornbach. Centers it over from the near half wall. Tipped off his skate and off the near post. Near half wall, Dornbach sent to the ice by Clement. No call as the puck worked back in the Denver zone. Here's Behrens. Feeds near wing for Dornbach, trying to slide it up through center ice. Rizzo got in his way. Now Red Savage lifts it in from center. Or it's gloved down there by Corona on his net, and Denver will skate it out of their own zone as Miami in a full five-man change. Behrens to the center ice red line, left wing, dumps it into the near side Miami zone. Murray up the near wing boards, Dukovac over the Pioneer line left wing. Lean behind the net, swings it around the boards to the far half wall. Here's Mazur on it. Never mind, those Ozar, beg your pardon. Redhawks work it free, send it to the near wing, but it went off the boards back to center, and Murray will control in his own zone for Miami. Tanano slides it up the right wing. Waldron tipped it with his stick. And this will go for an icing call here, as Waldron was about a step behind the center ice red line for the icing call. On a feed up the right wing. 7:19 to go in the first period. The faceoff will be in Pearson's zone to his left. And Eric Frank will drop the puck.
Pride of Indy.
He asked me what I was going to be for Halloween. I told him I'm going to be him.
You should be. Ask him if he can loan you a sweater.
It would be an honor to dress up as him for Halloween. Dukovac carries over the Pioneer line of the right wing. Denver works it off its zone right near circle. The shot, and Pearson fought it off with the left shoulder. It deflected up and out of play behind the net. Long stretch pass ahead. Denver does that so well. They move the puck really quickly up the ice in ways you don't see coming. That time Wright got a feed up the right wing. He busted his way toward the net. Pearson, a nice shoulder save to bail out the Redhawks with 7:05 to go in the opening period.
Yeah, their chances that they develop so quickly. I mean, they're just bang-bang plays that they start up and then they're over in the blink of an eye, it seems. And Denver's worked them really well. They've gotten a couple of scoring chances. They almost kind of turn into mini breakaways in those stretch passes.
Yep. Set up the far wing boards. Redhawks working out back to center. Rehnquist trying to feed it up the right wing. He could not. Taken over at the Redhawk line by Miami. As Drasner feeds it near side for Taransky. Played up in behind the Redhawk net. Here is Pearson with it. Spins it around the boards to the far side. Edwards gave it up there for his teammate in Capone. Far half wall. Came off his skate. Back to Helene, who's skating up the right wing over the Pioneer line. Helene, right point. spins his way to the far corner in the Red Hawk offensive zone. Met there by the Denver defender in Lucas Lovestad. But there will go to the right point, Miami offensive zone. Feed to the near circle, and Moulton trying to handle a bouncing puck. He got a shot off, but a nice right shoulder save by Krona. Edwards with it, off glass, back to center ice. Clement picks it up center circle, feeds for Moulton, who will dump it into the far corner of the Denver zone, and the Red Hawks look for a full five-man change here with 6:05 to go in the first period. Fed up through center ice, Denver trying to work it forward. Lorenz tipped it off his stick, back to the Red Hawks. Caragiallo carries over the Pioneer line left wing, will fling it in on Krona, who blockers it away to the far side. Lorenz picked up there by Caragiallo, high slot, loose puck. Daskus tried to spin around slapper, and Krona made the save with a breadbasket. 5:47 to go in period number one. The stoppage puts the draw to the left of him in the Denver net. We're scoreless.
Tempo's still very good on the Miami side of things. You can tell that the energy's really, really high. Thought William Helene had a heck of a shift when he was out there last time getting the Red Hawks up the ice.
Red Hawks win the draw in the offensive zone. Caragiallo, far corner, win the puck. Takes it behind the Denver net to the near wing. Through the faceoff circle, left point, it was Donato, couldn't pull the line. Here comes Denver with the Red Hawk line left wing. A shot by Lorenz. Pearson fought it off up high. The rebound kicked back to the left point. Behrens holds onto it. Far circle, he'll walk in. Dish it back to the far circle, down near wing. Lorenz, top of the near circle, fired a shot. Messenberg, nice save with the leg. The block. Burroughs loses it right point for Denver. It pops its way back out to center, and Lorenz will trail it back in his own end. Beats the Red Hawk line right wing for Burroughs. Through the middle, Devine chips it near corner Red Hawk zone. He'll swing through, try to pick it up in the offensive end as Denver gets some changes. Red Hawks in a battle here will win the puck in the near corner of their own end. Donato feeds up the right wing. Fletcher off the boards. Barbellini over the Pioneer line right side. Going to get held up there by the defender and Benning, and the Pioneers work it up the ice on the right wing. Benning dumps it over the Red Hawk line right wing. Kind of cut off there by Moulton. Sends it up the left side. Red Savage with a shot near circle. The pad of Krona made the stop. The rebound hung there for a second. Red Hawks working near half wall. As Fletcher sent a centering pass to the far wing. Barbellini there to pick it up. Got blown up by Lee with the right shoulder. Here comes Mazur up the ice. Over the Red Hawk line left wing. Moulton chases his dump in attempt. Swings it around the boards to the top of the zone right point. Denver keeps it in. Dornbach near circle, centers it over, and the far side wide open was Olmstead to pass in front of him. Back to the line of goal, it's Rizzo, top of the near circle, walks it down low. Dornbach is shot far post. Pearson the save with a chest, made another save as well, and a shot that came in from the same area, and the Red Hawks work the rebound back up high as Dukovac feeds it back for Moulton. Off the glass to center ice. Grabbed there by Olvestad. Feeds right side for Dornbach over the Red Hawk line. Top of the near circle. Rizzo a shot. Nice save by Pearson with the left pad. Rebound to the right point. And Olvestad will unintentionally chop it into the seventh row of the stands right by the right point. Everybody's all right down there, and we'll get an immediate timeout here with 3:40 left in period number one. No score, Miami and Denver. Looks like a good one so far. Miami Hockey on Red Hawk Radio. Left the opening period. Miami and Denver are scoreless here from Oxford, Ohio. Appreciate spending part of your Saturday with us here on Red Hawk Radio. Patrick Geshan, Luke West pulling with you high above the ice. Zach Rengers will have your first intermission report coming up in moments. Take a look at scores around the country. Talk about the first period. Look at some stats. And we'll break down the RedHawks playing these first 20 minutes. Drawn to the left side of Pearson. Helene wins it for the RedHawks. To the far wing it goes for Ryan Savage back to center. Bending near wing for Lee through center ice. Over the RedHawk line to the right wing. Chips it around the boards to the far corner. Drasner picks it up in his own zone. Sends it up the far wing boards. Bending fell over there. And it's under him, and they're going to well blow it dead. He's in an awkward position, too.
It's a pileup.
I think he just got tripped up, and then he had three other players come in and try to steal it under Benning.
Savage fell down on top of him, and then Hampus Rehquist came in for Miami and just decided to shove Tristan Lemire on top of the pile as well. The official said he wasn't going to have any of it, stopped it right away, yeah. So... sometimes those develop and they get really fun, but sometimes the officials don't want to sign paperwork and kick people out of games, so they blow them dead.
They don't get paid enough for that, as they would say. Throughout Pearson's right, Red Savage will take it against Dornbach. 3:21 to go in the first. Clean one for Denver, the offensive zone. Mayhew right point, hits the brakes. Sends it left point for Behrens. Around the boards it goes to the near corner where it's grabbed here by Mayhew. He's shoved off by Barbolini. Picked up near side by Red Savage. Feeds it middle. Here's Fletcher for the RedHawks. Over the Pioneer line right wing came Clement on the rush. He got knocked off the puck by Lee. Here's Behrens. Swings it around the boards far half wall. Lee gets the feed up the left wing. Through center ice, trying to dump it in off of Eric Frank, but didn't quite work. RedHawks get the lucky bounce. Here comes Miami over the line in the left wing, the offensive zone. Red Savage, a great shot in the near circle. Corona fought it off with the glove. Savage to the line for Murray. Left point, walks it middle. A shot deflected away by Behrens, the defender in front for Denver. Pops its way back to center and in the RedHawks zone. Here's Donato. Feeds it over there for Karen Diallo. Devine picks it up far corner, trying to feed it ahead for Karen Diallo. He picked it away. Left point, Bowiem got the feed. He could not keep it in, though. It was up high and bouncing. Red Savage sends it to the far corner of the Denver zone. Lee picks it up. Up the left wing it goes. Messenberg trying to close off the Denver breakout on the right wing. Did a good job in shutting down the rush attempt as up the ice was Bros, who's back out there after an apparent injury. It's good to see that. And behind the Denver net goes the puck, Bowiem to the left point for Murray. Couldn't quite get it to Messenberg. Denver back through center, feed ahead, Devine. Little break to the net, Devine on the forehand, trying to shove it in on Pearson's left pad, but Ludvig stood him up and lost his stick in the process. Left point, Pioneers with a puck. Here's Bowiem. Sends it down below the goal line and behind the net, Devine locked up with Murray. Far half wall, Bros. Through the far circle, back to the line it goes for Bowiem, who waits, left point. Far half wall walking in with a shot and a save by Pearson. Rebound as Bros there had a chance. Devine had another shot. Ludvig stood him up on the right pad. Close to the near corner. Donato backhands it all the way down the ice through Benning, and this will be an icing on Miami with 1:15 to go in period number one. As the RedHawks there will have to keep their tired guys out on the ice for this shift, but things kind of fall apart a little bit defensively there in the last sequence for the RedHawks.
Yeah, and Denver's going to put their top line out against this tired line for Miami. It's the fourth line and the third defensive pairing, so an ideal matchup for Denver here in the O-zone. But a tough sequence for sure, and Chris Bergeron's just going to call timeout straight away,
smart.
And you can't blame him. Yeah, I mean, it's one of those you don't want to burn the timeout that early, but that's a really tough matchup to not only have tired guys out there, but that's as unideal as you could draw it up, where Denver's
right.
Going to throw all their big guns out, their top forward line, top defensive pairing, and you've literally got your fourth line and your third defensive pairing out. So you can definitely see why he's going to call timeout there, and David Carl's going to take the chance to draw up a face-off play for his team.
Smart call, of course. David Carl is on the dry erase board in his fifth year with Denver. He's 33 years old, has already taken his team to two Frozen Four appearances. Beyond his years, really, when
yeah,
you look at
it. He's one of the best hockey minds at his age you're going to find. He trained under Jim Montgomery there. We know what Jim Montgomery did.
Oh, yeah.
Went to the NHL after he won the national championship. And I'm sure you hope, Patrick, he can do a great job with your Boston Bruins.
He already is.
He already
Don't
is
worry.
Doing a good job, absolutely. But Jim Montgomery really built this Denver program into what it is now, and I think David Carl's done a good job of building it, but they're just, I really think they're the toughest program to play in the country. They're just so yep. difficult to play against, and they're really one of the few teams you can point to where year in, year out, it's just really hard to find weaknesses in their game, and that's what makes them so tough for anybody on their schedule.
Yeah. They took care of the RedHawks last year, the playoffs at home without a ease. Break up the ice. Fletcher on the Pioneer line of the right wing. Feeds it. Middle barbell and he scores! The RedHawks won the faceoff to the far circle of their own zone. A Denver Pioneer fell over on the blue line. Fletcher poked it ahead. A two-on-one the other way. Fed it middle to Barbellini, who finished over the right shoulder of Crona. And with 1:06 to go in the opening period, the RedHawks take the lead 1-0.
Good timeout call, Patrick. I think so. Tough play for Denver there. Sean Behrens just blew a tire. That happens sometimes, but good job by the RedHawks. Be opportunistic. Rush up the ice. Great finish. He'll take that 1-0 here late in the first.
Barbellini from Fletcher, 18:54 of the first. Puck worked up in the RedHawks zone after the faceoff. Barbellini's six-game point streak was snapped last night. Trying to start another one. Pops its way back out to center, but William gets it off to Cassetti over the Pioneer line left wing. Benning in the near circle with 45 seconds to go in the first. Lifts it back in the RedHawks zone, Rehnquist. Spanks it off the boards to center. Waldred picks up the loose puck, fires it over the Pioneer line in the right wing, wraps its way to the near half wall of the Denver zone. Rose to the far corner for Benning. You had Waldred in on him to try to knock it free. Feeds the line, Rehnquist sends it down to the near circle. Dukovac at the feed, and his skates could not recover. But William picks it up off the far boards, all the way down the sheet. And this will be an icing call on Denver with 14.8 to go in period number one. You got a RedHawks team that's really got Denver on their heels right now.
Yeah, and I'm not quite sure about that call there. I believe that was by him to just straight away ice that puck this late in the period. You'd like to see him float that one out to center and maybe kill a little more time rather than giving Miami a free chance here late in the period in the offensive zone.
Draw to the right of Crona, one to the near corner for Denver in their own zone. Benning swings it to the far side for Red Savage, who picks it up to the right point, swings it to the near half wall. 3 seconds to go, but William with it for Denver, works it up back to the safety of center, and that will do it for the first 20 minutes of play. So the crowd is happy tonight at Steve Cady Arena as the teams head to the locker room for the first intermission. RedHawks carry a 1-0 lead into the break. On the goal for Matthew Barbellini, 18:54 into the first period. The assist to PJ Fletcher. Overall, Luke, RedHawks going to be pretty happy with the way things went in the opening period of play.
Yeah, that's what it's going to take. It's going to take three periods of that. It was high tempo. It was high pressure. There were chances up and down the ice, but thought they did a good job of limiting Denver on offense. Ludvig Pearson was there when he had to be, but really, I don't think he had to make any unbelievable saves. He made a couple good ones in that first period, but they didn't ask him, I don't think, to do anything crazy. He faced 13 shots, maybe a little high in that first period, but other than that, pretty solid. And that's, again, what it's going to take to beat this team. You're going to need three periods of really high energy and maybe a little luck as well with the RedHawks scoring that goal. You're going to need two more periods exactly like that. If you can do it, RedHawks would certainly love the result that they're going to get after this one. But tons and tons of work still to be done. And I think, though, overall, Patrick, like you said, it's got to be a pretty solid performance, I think, that Chris Bergeron and his staff are going to be pleased with here in the first intermission.
I would say so. Question is, can you carry it through the next 40 minutes?
That's
the challenge against this team in Denver.
Yep.
All right, intermission report time. Let's send it over to Zach Renger. Zach?
Thank you, Luke and Patrick. Great first period for the Miami RedHawks. Obviously, it was a game that was kind of sluggish to start off. Fast play, but nothing really happening. And then all of a sudden, lightning struck. Fletcher to Barbellini, and the RedHawks find themselves with a 1-0 lead. Looking at some of the stats from the first period, a very similar stat line for each team. Denver leads Miami with 13 shots on goal to 10 for Miami. But I think we can all agree, listening to this one, it didn't quite feel like that. Up until this point, it felt like Miami was really keeping the pressure on Denver the whole time, and Denver kind of got some shots here or there. We saw the defense start to break down a little bit with the third line out there against Denver's first line late in that first half, or excuse me, that first period. But then just like that, lightning in a bottle strikes. You win the faceoff on your own side of the ice. You get all the way down, Fletcher to Barbolini, and you know the rest from there. Looking around the board as well, 18 shots to the Miami 17, barely even score there. The real key for Miami was they had no penalties in that first period at all to Denver's one. Denver spent the 2 minutes in the penalty, and although it didn't lead to a goal for Miami, it was still nonetheless something nice to kind of hang your hat on, that you got that power play out of the way, and they had some nice looks, got some reps in the power play as well. Denver had 4 block shots to Miami's 1, and the faceoff is really where we saw Miami kind of excel last night, even though it wasn't the best night for the RedHawks. Once again, losing the faceoff battle, or they are winning it right now 11-10. So obviously something to hang your hat on there. If you're Miami, not only did you pick up that goal and you have the lead against the defending national champions, but they had a pretty nice game in terms of faceoffs as well. So Barbolini picks up the goal. Barbolini picks up the goal. Fletcher picks up the assist. And that's really what you need from Miami going forward. We heard Luke and Patrick say it. It was going to be the energy that comes out in this first period and so forth for this Miami team that decides what the result of this game was going to be. What did we see? Miami came out hot. They were throwing punches with Denver when they needed to respond, and that's what you get. You're going to end up with a 1-0 score there against Denver. So looking forward for the RedHawks, everyone's playing well right now. We saw Red Savage have a couple nice shots on goal, including that one where the puck got off the boards, grabbed it with his hand, dropped it down, had a really nice look against Krona. And credit to Magnus Krona, who's had himself a great game in terms of saves already. Had a couple nice looks from Miami that he squandered, and that's always a good thing to hang your hat on if you're in goal for a team that is losing to this point of the game. Ludvig Pearson, once again, having himself a monster night, and that's nothing new for Pearson and company. Obviously, he's had himself a great year, and that's been a big storyline for the RedHawks because they've been able to lean on him as much as they need to. But for Miami, they're going to look to keep the pressure up with guys like Barbolini, like Fletcher, and Savage. We saw Cassetti get in the mix a little bit there. Dukovic as well have had a nice first period. They're going to look to keep up that intensity going against Denver next round. And for Denver, obviously nothing changes. You got David Carl at the helm. He's going to draw up something. They're not going to go down in this one without a fight, especially after winning that game 4-0 last night. They're going to bring out their top line with Mazura, Rizzo, and Dornback, and that's going to be really hard for Miami to keep under control like they've done thus far. So it certainly feels like Miami's going to need to get another score at some point. They're going to have to get some more momentum going because this is a Denver team that is highly talented across the board, and they're not going to be able to hold them off for that long. So that'll about do it for our wrap-up of the first period. We got a few more minutes until second period kicks off. We'll have a little bit more on the intermission, look at the scoreboard in just a second, but we'll take a quick break here on Red Hawk Radio. We'll be right back. And we're back here on Red Hawk Radio. Time for our scoreboard segment in the first intermission of the game between the Miami RedHawks and the Denver Pioneers. Looking at the Atlantic Hockey Region, Canisius tied with Sacred Heart in the third period. 12-16 left in that one. Still a good one between Canisius and Sacred Heart. Holy Cross still yet to take on RIT. That game will drop the puck at 7 o'clock. Niagara and Mercyhurst in the same boat as well, where they'll drop puck at 7:05 Eastern time. The CCHA, Bowling Green, still yet to take on Minnesota State. That game set to start in about 8 minutes across the board at 6:05 Central time, or excuse me, an hour and 8 minutes for Central time there. St. Thomas and Ferris State still knotted up at nothing with 20 minutes in the first. RPI taking on Union at 7 o'clock. Brown and Yale locking up in what should be a good matchup at 7 o'clock Eastern time. Princeton and Harvard at 8 o'clock Eastern time. A little nightcap for you on a Saturday night between two Ivy League schools. Hockey East, UMass Lowell, taking on Boston University at 7 o'clock. That game over just about over an hour away. Northeastern versus Maine also at 7 o'clock, yet to tip off there. Massachusetts Merrimack, 7 o'clock, puck drop as well. Same with New Hampshire and Providence, so a lot of Hockey East action set to get going. That game, those games are going to be some big ones for the Hockey East. The only game in conference for the NCHC thus far, Miami leads Denver after one period with a 1-0 score. In the Big Ten, some big matchups between Minnesota and Ohio State with 16:47 left in the second period. Ohio State knotted up at 1 with Minnesota right now. Michigan State 0-0 with Notre Dame with 20 minutes left in the first period. Penn State taking on Wisconsin at 7 o'clock Central time. That one should be a good one in the Big Ten. Vermont and Colgate locked up at 1 in the third period with 10:40 left. Lindawood trailing Bentley big time, 3-1 in period 3 with 11:32 left on the clock there. St. Lawrence and Michigan Tech knotted up at 0. That game about to drop puck here shortly with 20 minutes left in the first period. Alaska and Northern Michigan also 0-0, just about to drop puck there with 20 minutes left in the first period. St. Cloud State playing Benjamin State at 6 o'clock Central time, so just about an hour away from that puck drop as well. Cornell, Minnesota, Duluth, 7 o'clock Central time puck drop. That should be a good one. All these in non-conference action. Of course, Omaha taking on Long Island at 7 o'clock Eastern time. Clarkson, Lake Superior, 7 o'clock Eastern time as well. Colorado College Air Force should be a good one at 7:05 Mountain time. North Dakota at 9 o'clock Pacific time. That one should be a nice nightcap for the 4-4 Sun Devils versus North Dakota, who comes into that one 3-2-1. Michigan and Western Michigan, like Luke and Patrick talked about, finally getting to actually play that game. That's going to be the final game of non-conference in college hockey. They're just about set to drop puck with 20 minutes left in the first period. And that'll do it for the scoreboard segment here on the first period intermission. We'll be back with a final cap and send it back to Patrick and Luke after a short break here on Red Hawk Radio.
1-0 Miami over Denver as we get ready to start period number two here from Oxford, Ohio. Patrick Geshan, Luke West pulling back with you. Zach Rengers as well from Steve Cady Arena at Oxford. So Luke, really good first period for the RedHawks. Question is, does it continue into the second?
Yeah, and because of how good that first period was, it was good because of the energy level, and that's what's so tough to sustain for three periods for Miami. I thought they were good on the forecheck. They got pucks in behind the Denver defense and were able to force them into some uncharacteristic turnovers deep in their zone. You get a good bounce towards the end of the period and you capitalize, and that's what it's going to take to beat a team like that. You need to be opportunistic. The RedHawks were in period number one.
Yep.
Got to do the exact same thing for two more periods. It's going to take discipline on the Miami side, and only time will tell if it'll continue.
That is true. So the RedHawks move from left to right across your radio here in the second period of play, and Denver will ice it right away. They won the faceoff back in their own zone, and Benning sent it all the way up the ice on the near wing for the icy call on a feed that never connected. So that stoppage comes 8 seconds into the second period, and the draw to the right of Corona is coming up. That'll feature Rizzo and Red Savage. Rizzo wins it back behind the net. Benning banks it to the near side for Mazur, who will try to crank it to center. Could not. Red Hawks reinforce it back in the Denver zone below the goal line. Barbellini and Benning tie up for it against the boards near corner of the Denver zone to our right. Two against two battle. Red Savage in there with Barbellini. Couple of pioneers as well. Mazur and Benning still digging at it. And the puck finally comes free. Barbellini to the right point. Clement shoots it in. Nice stop by Corona with a chest. The rebound is kicked away by Lee back to center and into the Red Hawks zone. Miami back to get it. Moltitz sends it up the left wing. Cassetti got it to the Denver zone. Pioneers work it up the right wing. Here's Rizzo over the Red Hawk line. He was a little bit delayed there as coming over the line. A step in front of him was Mazur for the offside. And that'll stop things here with 52 seconds gone by in period number two.
And you like to see that from Miami when you're able to get your top line on the ice against Denver's top line and really win that shift, which I thought the RedHawks did in the opening 50 seconds or so. You'd really like to see not only limitation of that top line for Denver, but also spending the majority of the time when they're on the ice in Miami's offensive zone. I thought Miami's top line did a good job.
RedHawks with a puck here in their own zone and behind the net. Goes to the far corner, dropped by Bros, squeezed off there by Murray. Went to the near corner for Rydquist. His Devine and him tie up for it. Bros now in the near corner, gets it back for Devine. RedHawks still pick off the pass, work it free. Rydquist sends it to the far corner. Dukovac chips it up the boards, back to center ice in the hands of the Pioneers. Barron's left wing chips it over the Red Hawk line, around the boards, the far half wall. Bros in his own zone trying to play it back to the right point. Mayhew was not in the area though, and he'll skate it back to his own end. Here's Barron's through center ice, chipped by Devine over the Red Hawk line, left wing in toward Pearson's net. Ludwig will stick it to the far corner. Murray kind of hits Devine over there. No call on the play as they'll battle for it far corner of the Red Hawk zone. Dukovac wins the loose puck, went there to Waldron, skates it up in a little rusty on the way. He'll fire it over the Pioneer line, right wing in on net. Waldron will. And Corona, the bread basket save with 18:06 to go in period number two, will stop the clock here with a draw to his left coming up.
Got to keep Magnus Corona moving. You saw him the goal in the first period for Miami. But if you're able to go a little more side to side on him rather than just sending those shots in, should be a little better off.
Redhawks with the puck here, the offensive zone, won the faceoff. Taranski far corner. Drazner had the pass hop over his stick. They regain control though, the RedHawks do. Ryan Savage spun off the puck there by Bouyam. Goes to Ozar, back for Bouyam. Turned over though, Taranski for the RedHawks. Offensive zone with a pass over. Ryan Savage could shoot it in. Just wide of the net on the far side. Never really got a clean shot away. Here comes the Pioneers over the RedHawk line of the right wing. Far side with it in the corner. That's Olvestad. Gets squeezed off there by Donato on the boards. Puck squirts its way to the near corner. On it here is Ryan Savage. Gave it back for Drazner. Up the right wing for Savage. That's Ryan. Gets stopped there at the center ice red line near wing as he got messed with by Tyler Haskins. Puck back near circle Denver zone. Sent up the left wing on a bad pass by Olvestad all the way down the ice. Trying to connect there with Haskins at the line, but it was 3 feet to his right, and we'll go all the way down for the icing call here on Denver. With 17:11 to go in period number two. And a 1-0 game led by Miami. Gerard Corona's right, Messenberg is in it alongside Owen Ozar. Clean wind to the near, or the far corner rather, the Denver zone. Lee picks it up, swings it around the boards, right point. Daskus will send a knuckle puck wrister along the ice that's gloved up by Corona. No traffic to contend with there for Corona. 17:05 to go in the second. Toronto is left coming up, and some new personnel out for both teams.
Some good zone time. Miami's even up the shot mark here in the early goings of the second. Energy is sustained so far through the early goings.
Yep. Toronto Corona's left. Clean win by Capone back to the far corner of the Denver zone. And it popped its way into the Red Hawk bench as a feed from Mike Benning went up the right wing boards trying to hit a pass to Lee. It popped off his stick into the Red Hawk bench. Barry Schutte made a nice catch and flips the puck over the glass to a deserving fan. Toronto Corona's right. Benning gets the faceoff win far corner for Denver in their zone. Works it up the right wing to center ice. Pioneers over the Red Hawk line now on the left wing. A feed forward, a shot. Pearson, a nice right pad save. A backhand pass by Capone went to Lemire, who made it a good backhand shot. And Pearson with a nice right pad shut down there. Pops its way high slot. Lee shatters his stick on a one-time chance. Left point picked up by Lemire. Skates it through the near circle. Lost control of the puck. Edwards comes in and steals it away for Denver. Back to Lemire in the near corner. Works his way over toward the far side. Daskus locks up against Lemire in the far corner. Rehnquist in there as well to mess with the puck. Taken away though by Kuhlman, who feeds the right wing for Messenberg. He'll skate it up to center ice, bank it over the Pioneer line on the right wing behind the net. Lee with it there for Denver. He'll feed it up left wing. Edwards over center ice, chips it over the Red Hawk line, left wing and behind the Miami net. Swings its way around to the far half wall for Fletcher. Up the left side for Red Savage. Gets stuck away there by Mazur, who will feed it back in his own net for Denver. Pioneers over the Red Hawk line here on the left wing. Dornbach hit hard by Clement. Goes near corner, Moulton, and behind the cage. Squeezed off there by Rizzo. Simo Rizzo up the near side board. Skits it up high in the zone. Feeds over in the far circle. When the puck is Mayhew. Left point, a shot came in off the stick of Behrens. It deflected off Red Savage's stick. Up and out of play on the wrister there with 15:35 to go in the second. And a little extracurricular stuff going on between Moulton and Mazur. In the near corner of the Red Hawk zone that the linesman will break up very quickly. A little bit of shoving in words that they will get into there. And the draw to Pearson's right is coming up here with 15:35 to go in the second.
Denver's continuing to do a good job working the puck low to high, high to low. They're going across the ice as well. Ludvig Pearson made an excellent save, probably his best of the night a few moments ago.
Yep.
But a good block there to snuff out that last opportunity by Red Savage.
Rocks with a faceoff in their own zone, working out back to center. Behrens feeds right wing, chipped over the Red Hawk line on the right side there by Dornbach in behind the Red Hawk net. Clement up the right wing, feet picked off left point by Behrens. Here's Dornbach, offensive zone Denver, fan on a wrist shot in the near circle. Loose puck picked up by Fletcher up the ice for the Red Hawks. Over the Pioneer line right wing to the far side. Red Savage let it pop off his stick to the far corner. Mazur near wing Denver in his zone end, chips it through center ice. Dukovac near circle Miami zone, skates it up the left wing, turns on his speed. Dukovac over the Pioneer line left wing in the far circle, trying to dance past Mayhew. Lost control of the puck near corner, he was blown up there by Mazur. And here come the Pioneers. Rizzo over the Red Hawk line here on the left wing, backhand feed down low, they score! Tic-tac-toe! It was finished up by Dornbach. Mayhew got the feed up high. He sent it from the near post to the far post in a 2-on-0 on the crease to Dornbach, who finished over the left pad of Pearson top shelf. And Denver has tied the game at one apiece, 14:44 to go in period number two.
And Miami just gets caught watching there. Really good play to rush up the ice for Max Dukovac, uses speed. But he comes down low and he's got no support down there low in the zone. He gets blown up in the corner. And the rest of the Redhawks just get caught puck watching. Weren't involved in the play on one end. Now the puck rushes back the other end. And Casey Dornbach finishes it off for Denver. Really no Redhawks in sight on the back check there for Miami. And Denver is always going to make you pay on plays like that.
That they will. I think the RedHawks a little bit startled there by Dukovac. Was literally blown up in the near corner before Denver worked that puck up the ice. That is little coast-to-coast carry. So the Pioneers here with a puck at center ice. Turned over to Miami. RedHawks over the Pioneer line left wing. Waldron dances through the far circle. Stripped off his stick there by Bowiem. Goes to the near half wall. Lorenz sticks it up back to center ice. Cassetti steals it away. Flips it far away for Drasner. Will put it in behind the Denver net. Krona there to stop it. Far corner for a play by Olvestad to the far circle. Bouncing puck grabbed by the RedHawks in their offensive zone. Then it comes off the stick of Waldron back to center. Lorenz caught it up there back in his own end for the Pioneers. And Denver a little bit of trouble here trying to get out of their own zone. It was tipped over to Bros after Waldron got a stick on an exit pass. Denver now with control here in their own end. Bros with it behind the net. 13:43 to go in the second period. We're all tied up in one, game two of the series. Puck comes over the line to the right wing into the RedHawks zone. Denver's rush kind of broken up there. Lorenz takes it back out to center ice. And you got a penalty behind the play as Ryan Savage was knocked over there by Denver's Tristan Bros. So that cross checks Ryan Savage in the middle of the ice, and you got all hell breaking loose in the center circle. Players shoving each other, they're going to calm it down. I saw behind the play Ryan Savage fall over in the RedHawks zone to our left as the puck was moving its way up the ice. I think he was contacted there by Bros. And then Ryan Savage came over to Bros in the neutral zone after the whistle was blown for the penalty against Bros. Bros cross-checked Ryan Savage over there again. And they're going to give Denver two penalties for cross-checking. There's nobody in the box for the RedHawks, which is surprising after all the shoving that came after the play. 13:29 to go here in the second immediate timeout. The only guy in the penalty box is Denver's Tristan Bros. And they have a 4-minute time on the clock for him, a double minor, I guess, for cross-checking. So Bros gonna sit two for cross-checking. So that means they called the original play where he knocked over Ryan Savage to start the whole sequence. Then he cross-checked him again in the neutral zone when Ryan Savage came up to confront Bros after the whistle was blown for the first penalty. So those are all the penalties that come into play. Bros gets two minors for cross-checking, and Luke, the RedHawks get a 4-minute power play here and a big chance with 13:29 to go in the second period in a tie game at one.
Yeah, huge chance for the RedHawks in the power play with a chance to go to work after they struggle a little bit on their first chance. Like we said, they really struggled to get things set up. Once they got set up, I thought they were pretty good in getting their puck movement, getting some shot lanes, but Denver gave them a tough time once they got the puck into the zone to make sure everyone was set. But for Tristan Bros, that's just a mental mistake, and a mental mistake you can't have. Your team just tied the game up, and you're playing against a team that you know needs to keep the energy high, and after that Denver goal, you thought maybe on their side of things they might be able to deflate Miami a little bit and take advantage. And that, I mean, that's uncharacteristic of a Denver team. They're not a team that normally does just silly things like that. And it's really surprising, Patrick, to see something like that happen to this team. But I mean, it was clear as day.
Right.
But the RedHawks get a gift. And now for Miami, this is almost a major. Of course, it's the double minor, so you get a minute less, but you got to cash in at least once here.
Right. So here we go, the RedHawks on the power play tonight are 0 for 1. They win the faceoff to start it off, get it up to the left point. Rydquist sends it down the boards. With it here is Red Savage, top of the far circle. Far corner for Ryan Savage, back for Red. Now Rydquist, center blue line. Will shoot it from the right point, little wrister, and Krona has it between the legs, squeezes the five hole with 13:09 to go in the second. And 3:41 to go on this double minor power play for Miami.
Not a bad shot there from Rydquist. And Miami did a good job of making that adjustment. When they get loose pucks, Miami's able to pick it up. They support the puck along the wall, and that allows them to really get into their shape and what they want on the power play, set up that chance.
Swung around the boards, RedHawks back at center. Rydquist plays it over the Pioneer line, left wing, they're offside, so Denver will get the puck and fired all the way down the ice, as Benning did that with Miami tagging up on the delayed offside call. So here's Rydquist, feeds right wing for Ryan Savage. RedHawks through center. Fletcher, the near wing feed. Ryan Savage over the Pioneer line. This is back for Red near circle. A bullet of a shot. A wrister that went way over the net. It bounced off the glass to center ice. Rehnquist with it near wing. Feeds Red Savage. Moving over the Pioneer line on the left wing. Here is Barbellini. Back to the left point for Fletcher, who kind of chopped it away there. Rehnquist down with it in his own net for the Redhawks. Skates it over the Pioneer line here on the right wing. Rehnquist spins it around the boards to the far half wall. Barbellini was there with it to the near half wall for Ryan Savage. Back to the right point. Fletcher sticks it forward. Here's Waldron to the far corner for Barbellini, who got tripped up there by Lee. Mazur will swing this one up the right wing boards all the way down the ice. Redhawks a little bit uncoordinated there on offense. And Pearson controls behind his net. 2:29 to go on the power play for Miami. 11:54 to go in the second. It's a 1-1 game. Redhawks out of their own zone. Waldron, rink wide to the left wing. Cassetti over the Pioneer line, left side. Swings it around the boards near corner. Dukovac let it go over his stick. Waldron with it near half wall, trying to work against Wright in a battle. As they tie up for it, near half wall battle. Redhawks win to the right point. Kuhlman shoots it in off a leg. Back to the left point. Here's Taransky, who will hold on to it. Spin around, feed center point for Kuhlman. Left point, Taransky. Far circle with it is Waldron. Near circle, Taransky. High slot, Kuhlman to drive. Great block by the links there. Mazur, Redhawks far circle, a shot. They score! Waldron! Power play goal with 1:46 to go on the man advantage. A lucky deflection over to Waldron, who finishes it off over the outstretched right leg of Krona. And with 11:15 to go in the second period, the patient Waldron will make it 2-1 Miami.
Yeah, this is just a broken play. And those broken plays were an area that where I thought Miami really struggled actually early on in that power play when pucks were bouncing off sticks and they were just kind of careening all over the place. But that time it just comes in on the back door, and it's not often you get two chances from that place. John Waldron has set up perfectly right along the near post. He fans on the shot, picks it back up, and puts it over the right shoulder of Magnus Krona. Miami converts on the power play. That's what you needed. Another energy burst here in the second for the Redhawks.
Yep. John Waldron's first career goal. Second career point. 2-1. With 11 minutes to go in the second, Miami does take advantage of the power play, but now the Pioneers going to get a power play as the puck after the center ice faceoff went back in the Redhawks zone. A holding call is coming here to Blake Messenberg. Something away from the play. You're right, it was a broken play, Luke. The puck ended up in on the crease of Krona, kind of deflected the far circle of the Miami offensive zone. It was picked up there by Waldron, who stick handled for a good 5 seconds and then found a lane to shoot it, and did so over the left shoulder and the right shoulder and the right pad area of Krona. 10:56 to go in the second. So now the Pioneers on a power play after the Messenberg minor for holding. We'll try to tie it up here in the middle stages of the second. They win the draw in the offensive zone to start off the power play. Kind of made its way in on Pearson, who made the cover with his right pad. So with 3 seconds gone by to start the power play, Pioneers will get this draw on the near side of their offensive zone. A Denver power play that is getting its first look tonight. Near circle, Rizzo to the Dornbach. Left point now, Bowiem. Center point with it is Benning. Far side, Bowiem. Right point, slides it far circle. On it there was Rizzo. Back to the near circle now for Benning. Center point, Bowiem. A drive, right pat St. Pearson. Deflects to the near corner. Back to the line, Bowiem. Stuck it forward. Redhawks picked it off. Red Savage there sent it down the ice. And Bowiem back to chase it for Denver. Penalty kill change for the Redhawks. Bowiem dishes back. Here's Rizzo through center ice over the Redhawk line on the right wing. Dishes over on the far side there for Dornbach. We'll grab it here for Benning on the near wing for Denver. Play at middle, chipped over the Redhawk line, left wing by Mazur. Clement danced around him. Puck goes over to the far half wall where Dornbach takes over for Denver. Right point, Williams got it for the Pioneers. Sends it down low, Missouri behind the net. Now Moulton waiting near corner for the Redhawks. Playing up to the near wing, here is Benning. Back to Bowiem, now Rizzo near circle with 50 to go on the power play for Denver. Pioneers in the offensive zone. Rizzo trying to shoot it off the near post. takes the puck behind the net. Right point for William, near circle, one-timer, door blocked his shot, deflected off Pearson's stick, off the glass behind the net. Miners still working here in the offensive zone, near circle, door blocked a drive. Pearson, I think, got a piece of that with his left shoulder, and it was sent all the way down the ice back in the Denver zone with 25 to go in the power play for the Pioneers. Here's Boehm, skates it from back in his own end. Feeds the right wing over the Red Hawk line right side, chipped in by Devine to the near corner of the Red Hawk zone. Left point with it is Barron, slides it top of the far circle. Walking in was Lorenz, dished it out. Now at the right point for a pass to Barron's near circle. Rick White trying to hit over there was Bros, picked off. Red Hawks almost get the player coming out of the penalty box. Breakaway a feet ahead to Messenberg, was out of his reach. Off the stick of Donato. Far corner, Fletcher picks it up. Miami in the offensive zone. We're back to 5-on-5. The power play is over for Denver. 8:35 to go in the second. Near circle, Rehnquist gets it up high in the slot, and Ryan Savage rips a one-timer over the Denver net. Far corner, Bros trying to grab a loose puck, clearing a tip, picked off. Rehnquist, right point with a shot. Get blocked down in front, I believe, there by Lorenz. We'll work it up the ice up the near wing, and Taransky grabs it back in the Red Hawk zone. Feeds near circle there for Rehnquist. Up the right wing boards, picked up by Taransky over the Pioneer line, middle of the ice, drops it back. Colleen, the shot. Blocked down there by Lemire. Mayhew will tie up with Colleen in the far corner. Now it's grabbed up the ice on the far side for Edwards. Rick White feed near wing, Lorenz chips it over the Red Hawk line. Now you get Lee with it left wing. We'll dump it in behind Pearson's net to the far corner where Drafter there to pick it up. He will get out the pitching wedge, lob it out to center ice. Loved down by Mayhew. Near wing play over to Lee. Up the boards, or it's sent down to the zone there by the Red Hawks. Axel Kuhlman kind of hung up in the air, fell down in a sea of players. Denver gets it. Capone over the Red Hawk line, left wing. Rick wide feet, chipped in from the right point by Lemire to the near corner of Miami zone. Kuhlman to Helene, swings it around the boards in the far wing. Dukovac now with it for Miami. Takes it right wing and dumps it over the Pioneer line and behind the Denver net. Corona to the near corner. Mayhew banks it off the boards. Back up the near wing for Brett Edwards. It was hit there by Cassetti up in front of the penalty boxes. Pioneers still working though in the offensive zone, left wing, and a penalty though coming up. There was a hit behind the play in front of the penalty boxes in the neutral zone. I think the Red Hawks are getting a call here, and they are. Who's going to go though? That's the question. I noticed a late hit kind of behind the play once the puck left the area where that battle was in front of the boxes, and they're going to take Waldron. 2 minutes for boarding. So the penalty's going to put Denver back in the power play when we return. 7:07 left, period number two. The Red Hawks lead it 2-1, and this is Miami Hockey on Red Hawk Radio. .7:07 to go here in the second period. 2-1 Miami over Denver. Patrick Geshan, Luke West pulling back with you. High above the ice, Zach Rengers as well at Steve Cady Arena. A power play for Denver out of our timeout. The Red Hawks going to have to come up with a big kill here. And the draw on the near side of Pearson is won by Denver to start it off. Pioneers 0-1 on the power play this afternoon. Mazur swings it around near half wall for Denver. Gets it to the line for Benning. Center point, far circle. Rizzo a drive at Pearson. Great rebound control on the slapper through traffic. Holds on to the breadbasket there to stop the clock. 6:47 left at period number two. There's 1:41 to go in the power play for Denver.
And man, they've just moved the puck so well, don't they? Denver on the power play. They open up a lot of lanes with their passing.
Drive from the right point by Benning. Rebounded front, knocked around in the slot. And get a whistle for a hand pass. He got popped up in the air. A few hands got on it. I'm not sure who it's against, though. It's like on Miami.
They said it would be against Miami, but I really thought that that puck was played in the defensive zone, which it shouldn't technically be a hand pass there, but I guess they're going to say that it was played just outside the blue line.
Here's P.J. Fletcher. RedHawks win the draw to the right of Pearson after the hand pass. Get it down to two in the Denver zone. 1:24 to go. The power play turned over. Rhett Savage's shot near circle. Good left pad seen by Krona. Point blank there and a bad pass for Denver. Missouri over the Red Hawk line left wing. Benning left point with it. Slides it rink wide. Rizzo top the far circle. Missouri up front. The shot there and a nice save by Pearson off the stick of Benning with a left flank. Rebound came in front and Ludwig covers it. As Denver sent about four players into the crease there to try to go after a loose puck that kind of popped its way in front of the cage. Ludwig holds on, and with 6:11 to go in the second, the draw will be to his left, I think, with a 1:04 to go in this Denver power play. This building is probably alive, the most we've seen all weekend.
Oh, yeah, this has been a really exciting past couple sequences. Like you mentioned, Patrick, Denver's starting to press their forwards a little bit lower, start to bring them more into the crease, and Ludwig Pearson's made some nice saves, but he's let a couple of pucks squirt in behind him, kind of in those soft spots along the post. He's got to be careful with his rebound control.
Clean one back to the near corner for the Red Hawks. Barbellini lost it, gave it up for Clement, and they passed it right in front of their own net. Bouncing puck, left circle, and the Rens, lucky for Miami, had it hop over his stick. Otherwise, he would have had a silver platter chance on Pearson with a wrister. Burrows over the Red Hawk line right wing as it came back to center. Feeds far circle to Vine. Right point for Behrens. Top of the far circle now with a puck. Burrows. Far corner, they go down low with it was Haskins. Behrens now left point, far circle, Burrows, one-timer sent wide to the far side of the net. 25 to go in the power play for Denver. Devine, center point, Behrens back near circle. Devine shoots, a snapper there that went over the top left corner of the net for Pearson. Far half wall, Denver still the puck, Burrows, rink wide near circle, Devine in front. They try to jam it on the far post. Lorenz sent it wide. 8 to go on the power play. Behrens, center point, wrister, and Ludwig Pearson with a glove save. Reaching out to his left, Moulton and Lorenz do a Brick Street dance in the high slot after the whistle. And with 5:11 to go in the second, it is a 4 seconds left in the Denver power play, and the draw to Pearson's left is coming up.
Man, Denver has created every type of chance you could possibly imagine on this power play. They've had shots, they've had backdoor feeds, they've had tipped plays from the point. And Miami's had some good play down low in front of their own net. That time Ludwig Pearson making a good save. But man, Denver has been swarming on this power play.
They have. The Red Hawks have used Pearson to their advantage tonight, as they do every night. You got a penalty coming here in Miami.
Contact. It's going to be on Waldron.
Away from the play.
I believe it's going to be on Waldron for playing the puck when his feet were still in the penalty box.
He was coming out as the time expired.
I believe it's going to be on him unless it's something away from the puck.
Well, the entire Denver bench is yelling. The puck swerved up the right wing as the penalty was expiring right in front of the penalty boxes in the neutral zone. And you're right, Waldron, it's a judgment call there. I believe he played the puck with his feet in the box as it kind of came up.
It's the right call, and that's just unfortunate that the play happens to come in front of the box at that exact time. But Waldron, for him, he's got to know you need to put 2 feet on the ice before you can play the puck.
Right.
And that's just an unfortunate break for Miami after a really nice kill where you had a power play on the other side that was moving the puck well, that was doing good things, but you really fell back into your defensive shape well. And it's right back to work here with 4:53 to go.
In period number two, media timeout, we could keep it right here as a big power play coming up for Denver. They're 0 for 2 on the man advantage tonight. This crowd has had a lot to cheer about tonight, Luke, and this is going to be, you can feel, just a critical point in this game. Pioneers really found a good groove in their last power play. They just couldn't really solve one piece of the Miami defense, and that was Ludwig Pearson. So the question is, can you solve Pearson here on this power play? And just a really disappointing timing for Denver to go back in the man advantage after the RedHawks could really use that momentum from the last kill to kind of propel them forward here through the last part of the second period. But Pioneers get another shot, and the defense has to show up again for Miami.
Yep, they're going to get another shot, but coaching staff was off their perches and down with the whiteboard. Zach Sizek down there, the new assistant coach for the RedHawks in his first year, was drawing up some stuff on the board for the RedHawks penalty kill to work with. I'd imagine the words "stop chasing the puck" were in there at some point. RedHawks got a little bit pulled out and a little bit wide, caught chasing a couple times, opened up some chances for Denver on that last power play.
Pioneers win the faceoff to start the power play. Benning to the near circle here for a play to Dornbach. Left point Benning, far circle with a puck. His shot came in. That went wide of the net from Ozar. Deflected its way left point. Benning slides it down below the goal line. Rizzo swings it around the boards. Far half wall. Bowiem is on it in the far corner. Backhand play to the left point for Mazur. Gets it down near circle for Bowiem. Holds onto it. 30 seconds gone by. The power play for Denver. Rink wide. Kind of a weak one-timer there. Fanning on it. Rizzo. Little squeaker in on Pearson on the ice. He'll make the cover. Faceoff to his left is coming up with 1:26 to go on the power play for Denver. And a 4 minutes and 18 seconds to go in the second period in a 2-1 game. Led by the RedHawks. Clean one back for Dornbach for Denver in the offensive zone. Far circle. Pioneers continue in the offensive end of the power play. Near circle, a drive by Benning. Nice save by Pearson with the right pad. And it's floated all the way down the ice by Rehnquist on the rebound to clear on the PK for Miami. Bowiem out of his own end. Feeds left wing Rizzo. 1:05 to go in the Denver power play. Pioneers chip it over the Red Hawk line here on the right wing. It's Dornbach to the far corner. Cassetti first to it. Barbellini left wing. Skates it out of the zone through center ice over the Pioneer line. Chips it far corner. Red Hawks get a full four-man penalty kill change as Denver back into their own zone. It is Benning with a puck over the Red Hawk line of the right wing with 43 to go on the power play. Fires the shot wide right of the cage. Near corner Rizzo. Backhand feed up the boards. Will not reach Behrens. Picked off by Red Savage over the Pioneer line here on the right side. He'll try to make a fancy move on Behrens in the near circle, but came off his stick. He'll regain control. Feed it back to the neutral zone, or the Red Hawks will play a little bit of time wasting here in their own end. Draster sends it all the way down the ice. Corona will get it behind his own net. 15 to go in the power play here for Denver. 3:05 to go in the second. Red Hawks lead 2-1. Up the right wing through center over the Red Hawk line. That's Devine through the far corner. Try to center it over. Went off the skein of Donato. Picked up by Cassetti. And he'll float it all the way down the ice. In on Krona's net. That takes care of the Denver power play. And the Red Hawks with a huge, huge kill here late in the second. We're back to 5-on-5. Rolls over the Red Hawk line here on the left wing. Takes it behind the net to the far corner. Donato squeezed him off there on the far side of the ice. Drazner was on it. Now it's Taransky up the left wing through center. He got hit hard in front of the benches there by Lee. Lee back with it for Denver. Backhand play for Rehnquist through the center ice area. Taransky over the Pioneer line on the right wing. Gave it up for Drazner. We'll flip this one into the Denver zone in the near corner. Red Hawks trying to change defensemen here. Ryan Savage of the offensive zone finds Helene. Left wing feed to the far corner for Taransky. Leave it up back for Helene. Down low for Lee. For Denver, trying to shovel this one out. Now it's Helene in the far corner. Got tied up there with Lee. Now Capone was on it. Here's Behrens coming down low. It's the battle for it, two against two. Shoved over down in the battle is Taransky. No call, 1:47 to go in the second. Pioneers up through center ice over the Red Hawk line left wing. Capone let it go off his stick. Murray picks it up for Miami near corner. Red Hawks work it out back to center ice. Right wing Ryan Savage let it hop over the Pioneer line. Mayhew takes over for Denver. Rush the other way for the Pioneers. Here comes Lemire over the Red Hawk line on the right wing. He fired a wrister. Murray deflected it with his skate and it went up and out of play with 1:28 to go in period number two. Puck that deflected on a wrister behind the Red Hawk net, and the draw to Pearson's left is coming up in a 2-1 game led by Miami.
And I like Miami's ability to be able to get out of their own zone after those penalty kills. Sometimes having a kill for that long can kind of get you sunk back in your own zone a little bit, but Miami's able to get some rushes up the ice.
Left point with it is Daskus. Sends it back to center. Edwards for Denver in his own zone. Will bring it around to the near corner. Bending on it for the Pioneers. Left wing for Mayhew. Skates it up, lifts it through center, cross corner all the way down the ice. The icing waved off, far corner Miami zone. Edwards to the near corner for Ozar. Denver sets up at the offensive end here with a minute to go in the second. It caroms off Messenberg's skate back into the Denver zone where Benning will grab it for the Pioneers. Feed it again off Messenberg, loose puck picked up by Benning. And he will put it into the Denver bench, trying to send it up the right wing. Off the boards, went a little bit too high there in the neutral zone. Faceoff will come on the Pioneer right wing, closest to their blue line with 49.4 to go in period number two. RedHawks hold on to the one goal lead. Denver's won seven straight meetings against Miami. That's the longest winning streak they've ever had in the all-time series. Lee with it here in the near corner for Denver. In their own zone, works it up the near wing boards. Pioneers back to center ice. Here's Mazura of the Red Hawk line left wing. Get tied up there in the corner with Moulton. Moulton will win the battle. Red Savage with a puck now. Up the near wing boards, 27 seconds left in the second period. Barbellini left wing in the center ice red line, trying to chip it ahead. He could not. Moulton to the near wing. Picked off there by Dornbach. Lifts it out all the way down the ice. The Red Hawk did, and that will be no icing, they say, as Lee back to get it for Denver. Here's Rizzo over the Red Hawk line left wing. Seven to go in the period. Feeds a far circle. A shot by Mazur. And a great stick by Rehquist. Deflects it up and out of play. He got there just in time. On a point blank look for Mazur in the far circle. Faceoff comes to the Red Hawk zone with 4.7 to go in period number two.
Don't want to get caught too much on the back check late in periods like that. But a good play by Hampus Rehquist. And now Miami needs to bear down on this draw. I think David Carl now arguing with the official that that play earlier should not have been ice, or the icing wave should not have been the case. Yep. But regardless, face-off now to the left of Ludwig Pearson.
Capone and Cassetti. Clean win for the Red Hawks. Will just bury it below their own goal line here. That'll run out the time in period number two. All right. So Miami 2, Denver 1 after 40 minutes of play. One more period of regulation left in the series. And Miami in that second period, Luke, pretty good job to just stay with the Pioneers. We're not really seeing the best from Denver, I don't think, tonight at all. Pioneers played much better last night. They moved the puck a lot better. But if you're in Miami, you got to be happy with where things stand here after the middle stanza of the game, and especially your special teams. Penalty kill came up big there for the Red Hawks, and they score the go-ahead goal on the power play. Waldron did that, and so Miami, it's just about finishing it out and closing it out here in the final 20 minutes of play after the second intermission.
Yeah, I thought that was another good period in terms of energy for the Red Hawks. I thought it was high. Saw a really nice special teams play, as you said. You alluded to the penalty kill, which was great, but also the power play goal that lifted Miami back out in front. I thought their response to that Denver goal was really good. Of course, they kind of got a gift with that double minor that really aided them to get a better response. But I thought overall, yeah, it's got to be another period that Miami can be pretty happy with. I think the message going into the locker room is if you play that way for another 20 minutes and you don't take three penalties in a period, you're probably going to be fine. And so I think that's just got to be the goal for Miami moving forward. It was unfortunate that John Waldron kind of had that second call on him. The first call on him obviously wasn't the best penalty to take. Like you said, it was behind the play. But the second one, just kind of a quick mental mistake. But the Red Hawks were able to convert on the penalty kill. And I thought the special teams play, it's been the difference so far, really, if you look towards it. Miami's been perfect on the PK and a tally on the power play as well. So, yeah, the Red Hawks got to be pleased with how they've played through two periods. Got to finish, but got to stay out of the box as well.
That is a fact. Big period coming up in the series for Miami, up 2-1 over Denver. Time for the second intermission, and we send it over to Zach Renger. Zach.
Thank you, Patrick. Obviously, a super electric second period for the Miami RedHawks. It had a lot of action all together, all around. Denver got in on the action. Miami had a goal. Plenty of penalty minutes. A whole lot to break down from that second half. So let's go storyline. Obviously, we saw Casey Dornbach have the equalizer goal. That was at 14:45 6:44 left in the second period. And then just like that, Miami responds. John Waldron picking up his first goal of his career on the power play for the RedHawks. That was with 11:15 left in the second period. Obviously, the goals are not the only storyline in that second period. We saw a lot of penalty minutes, 4 for each side to be exact. We saw the double penalty for Denver that really killed them, that put Miami on the power play for an extended period of time, which we saw John Waldron take advantage of. Obviously, then you see Waldron on the other side pick up the penalty, and then the mental mistake, like Luke highlighted, coming onto the field, touching the puck without both skates on the ground. Not what you're looking for the RedHawks, but luckily, the RedHawks played good enough, man down defense, kind of iced the puck when they need to, got it out of there, didn't make anything too risky for Pearson in goal, and that was really the storyline of that first half, or excuse me, that second period. Now let's look at some of the stats for this game. Obviously, goals in this one, Miami leads it by a score of 2-1 after the second period, looking to close out what could be a monumental win, ending the win streak for Denver in this series. They're going to need to play a great 20 minutes to end this game in the third period, but it's certainly something that could happen, and it's got a clear path to that going forward. Obviously, Miami leading in goals. They also lead assists in 3-2. Shots on goal, actually. Interestingly enough, Denver leads by a significant margin, 27-16. Obviously, this is anticipated. We saw a super long power play for Denver. They took a lot of shots. Luckily, Pearson was just a rock in the goal, really leading this whole charge on the defensive end for Miami. They were able to stop any real attack that Denver had, and Pearson had himself a great second period as well. Overall shots, Miami actually getting outshot by 11 shots at 41-30. Obviously, when you're still leading 2-1 with that kind of numbers, that's something to improve on in the third period, but nonetheless, you're very, very happy to be able to be leading this game, having 11 less shots than your opponent. Obviously, Miami, the only team to score a power play goal. They've got 1-0 there. No shorthanded goals for either squad thus far. 3 penalties for each squad. Obviously not the cleanest game that Miami could have played. And luckily their defense was good enough to hold up man down. Obviously, you can cut out one of those penalties fairly easily. Just a mental mistake from Waldron coming out of the box. Not something that you need to really worry about going forward, because I feel like that's a mistake. You make it once, you're not really going to make it again. So That's not something to worry about too much for the RedHawks. Faceoffs really close. Now Denver has won 23 to Miami's 22. And we saw Miami after the first period, they had that little lead in terms of the faceoffs, and that could really be a big storyline going forward. Miami going to continue to win those faceoffs. That's how they got that leading goal, was a faceoff that was deep in their end in the first period. Got all the way down the floor and ended up having a nice goal in that first period to give them that initial lead. So if they can keep winning faceoffs, that puts them at a great advantage to try to win this game. Block shots, Denver has 9 to Miami's 7. Not a huge issue. Miami's defense has been smothering thus far. They've played a great game blocking shots when they can, and that's really helped out Pearson in goal. And then penalty minutes knotted up at 6-6. Obviously, You can take off 2 minutes of that, chalk it up as just inexperience, and they'll get better with that after that touching without letting 2 feet hit the ice penalty from Waldron. So nonetheless, Miami plays a very clean, very high energy second period, and that's going to be the storyline going into the third, is who can keep this energy up and what team is going to have the momentum going down the final stretch of the third period. This could be a monumental win for Miami's program. Obviously, coming into this one, lost a few straight against a high-powered Denver team who, like we said many times tonight, the defending national champions. They handed them a big loss last night at 4-0, and Miami definitely came in with a chip on their shoulder. in this one, and they're looking to pick up a nice series-tying win at home. That would really set them up well in the NCHC going forward this season. Some other storylines from the first half, or excuse me, the second period. We saw a couple mix-ups there, some penalty minutes. Obviously, those can all go hand-in-hand with some fights on the ice. We saw Bros and Savage. That's where Bros picked up that double penalty, spent 4 minutes in the box for that, kind of mixing it up with Savage on the Miami side of the floor. Kind of an interesting after the play was over, just pushed Savage to the ground, and obviously you're going to be headed to the penalty box because of that. And then we also saw Moulton and Mazur mixing it up in the boards for Miami. So you always have to keep an eye on those storylines. You never know where those could escalate going forward. Obviously, Miami going to look to play a mentally sound third period to try to end this one off, because that's going to be the key against a high-powered Denver team like we've seen. You got to play smart, and you can't afford any unnecessary mistakes, and that's what Miami's going to look to do here in this game. So that'll about do it for our second period recap. Obviously, that was a great period for the Miami RedHawks. They're going to look to continue that great momentum and energy into the third period. We'll be back with our scoreboard segment for the second intermission after a short break here on Red Hawk Radio. Stay tuned. And we're back here on Red Hawk Radio, our scoreboard segment for the second intermission here between the Miami RedHawks and the Denver Pioneers. Looking across college hockey, Canisius drops a big one to Sacred Heart. 3-1 the score there. RIT beating Holy Cross right now, 3-2. Final, actually, in overtime. Big win there for RIT over Holy Cross. Niagara and Mercier is just about to puck drop for that game. That one coming up soon. St. Thomas over Ferris State right now after the first period, up 2-0. Bowling Green and Minnesota State set to drop puck, in just a few minutes. RPI and Union are dropping puck in about 7 minutes or so at 7 o'clock Eastern time. Brown and Yale just about set with 20 minutes in the first period. 0-0 the score there. And the nightcap, Princeton and Harvard at 8 o'clock. Coming up, that game should be a good one between two teams just starting their seasons. UMass Lowell and Boston University going to get set just in about 7 minutes. 7 o'clock should be a good one there. Northeastern and Maine at 0-0, just getting set for that game. UMass and Merrimack also getting set at 7 o'clock. Same with Providence and New Hampshire. So a lot of action coming up in Hockey East. Looking towards the NCHC, obviously Miami leads this one 2-1, looking to finish the deal against the highly talented Pioneers of Denver University. In the Big Ten, it's Minnesota 4, Ohio State 1 late in the third. That game should end up being a Golden Gophers win over the Buckeyes. Michigan State up 1-0 over Notre Dame at the end of the first period, and Penn State and Wisconsin yet to drop puck. Colgate and Vermont tied up at 1. Bentley wins over Lindenwood at a score of 3-1. St. Lawrence and Michigan Tech tied at 0 after the first period, about set for the second period action. Alaska Northern Michigan tied at 1, getting ready for the second period there. Cornell, Minnesota Duluth going to need an extra hour before they drop puck in that game. Omaha, Long Island in the period, and just about to start their game. Clarkson, Lake Superior. Lake Superior winning that one 2-0 over Clarkson right now. And then the biggest game right now, Michigan over Western Michigan, 2-1 with 1:23 left in the first period. And that'll round out our scoreboard segment. Now hand it over to Luke and Patrick getting ready for the third period.
All right, Zach, thank you very much. 2-1 Miami leaders over Denver as we get the third period started here from Steve Cady Arena in Oxford. And Luke, you said off the air just a few moments ago, for Miami, this is the biggest period of the year.
It indeed is. It's the biggest period of the year for Miami. We knew, Patrick, we talked about it so much leading up to this weekend, that this was a measuring stick weekend. And now just one period separates yourselves from potentially what you think of as, I think, a really solid weekend if you were able to pick up a split against a really good Denver team. But 20 minutes is a long, long time, and we've seen how much can unfold in just one period. This game is far from over, and Miami knows that. But I've been impressed with their play through two periods. All they got to do now is finish.
RedHawks trying to beat Denver for the first time on their home ice since January 5th, 2018. It's been a while. The mayor of Indianapolis, Eric Frank, drops the puck, and Denver's out of their own zone. Here's Mazur, banks it over the Red Hawk line on the right wing to the near corner. Jack Clement is with it, far side for Dylan Moulton. The far wing boards here, where it's grabbed by P.J. Fletcher. Red Hawks break out of their own zone. Here's Barbellini, takes it over the Pioneer line on the left wing. It's the breaks to the near corners. He was shoved off there by Mazur. Now Mazur hands it off to Dorenbach for Denver. Rink wide left wing for Lee. Far circle, looking to work it up the left wing. He'll turn back in his own end. Feed it to the near side here for Benning. And his pass goes all the way down the ice on Pearson, who makes the right pad stop to the far half wall in the Red Hawk zone. Fletcher feeds it middle. Here's Moulton for Miami. Left wing for Rydquist. Spins it around the boards off a stanchion. It popped in front of the Denver net, and Behrens was there to grab it. No Red Hawk in the area, luckily for the Pioneers. Here's Devine over the Red Hawk line right wing. Feeds Bros, far circle Mayhew. The puck went off his skates. Drasner far side for Cassetti. Now Waldron will grab it for the Red Hawks back to center. Over the Pioneer line of the right wing, Waldron. Far circle Cassetti, a rip 5 feet over the net. goes off the glass, back to center in the Red Hawks zone. Kumlin up the right wing for Cassetti over the Pioneer line, right side and behind the net for Krona. On the far wing for Lorenz. Right point slid in there by Ryan Savage to the near corner for Dukovac. And we'll trip up on Bros. Red Hawks sit up in the offensive end to our left. Donato right point for Kumlin. A shot on a wrister wide to the far side of the net. Bros gets it near half wall. Denver works it out up the near wing. Here's Mayhew. Gets to the center ice red line right wing and dumps it in behind the cage. Pearson there to stop it. Kumlin to the near corner up the boards back for Denver. On it here is Bowiem for Ozar at center ice. Right wing is right. Chips it over the Red Hawk line behind the net. Pearson's on it. Spins it around the boards to the near half wall. On the puck is Taransky. Left wing play over the Pioneer line for Ryan Savage. Never quite connected though. The puck squirts off his stick over toward the far corner. Murray in the offensive zone for Miami. Lost it as well. Wolvestad swings it around to the near half wall in the Denver zone. Right below the goal line and behind his own net to Olvestad. Far wing now, Pioneers work it. Over the Red Hawk line, right wing is right with a shot. Pearson fought it off with the right shoulder. And the rebound coming in, sent wide of the net by Ozar. Left point lead with a bomb off a stick of Murray. Back to the right point for Benning. Center point, he'll walk it. Feed it down low to the far circle. Off the mark there for his teammate in Olvestad. Now right point Benning. Near circle, let it go into the near corner. Daskus was on it there, squeezed him off. And the puck squirts its way back out center ice. Here's Haskins back in the Red Hawk zone. Daskus squeezed off there by Benning. Feeds it forward. Here's Caringiallo back in the near circle for Rehnquist. Off the boards to the far half wall for Messenberg. Gave it up there for Caringiallo. Lee back in his own zone for Denver. He'll chase an errant puck that is swung around the boards to the near wing by Krona. 16:38 to go in the third. It's 2-1 Miami. Here's Lemire for Denver. Over the Red Hawk line right wing. Capone with a shot. Top of the near circle. Off his stick to the left point where it's sent in there by Mayhew. Nice save made by Pearson with a right pad to the near half wall. Devine is on it. Now Lemire down to the near corner of the offensive zone for Denver. Squirted off his stick. Caringiallo with it for the Red Hawks. Through center ice, got stopped there at the red line. Here comes Denver over the Red Hawk line right wing. Behrens places the puck below the goal line for Capone. Now it's Clement, works it up the far wing boards. This will go all the way down the ice for an icing call on the Red Hawks on a pass that never really connected to anyone. And with 16:01 to go in the third, the draw to Pearson's right should be coming up. 2-1 Red Hawks.
Yeah, Miami's been sitting back a little bit, I think, too much to start this period. Their defense has been solid. They haven't allowed Denver to get too much in on goal of any quality.
All right.
But you can only let Denver skate around the Ozone so long before they're going to make something happen.
Left point, Benning shoots it in up high on Red Savage, who knocks it down. Right point, here's Bazur. Let it go there for Rizzo. Popped up high on him. Right point with it is Bouillon. Bouncing puck controlled by the Red Hawks. They work it up through center ice to the near corner of the Denver zone. Benning and Red Savage will battle for it here. Bouillon behind the net for Denver. Up the left wing for Rizzo. Tosses back for Mazur. Room to skate over the Red Hawk line right wing. Break to the net. He scores! A snipe by Mazur, who finds the back of the net for the fourth time this weekend. A simple snapper at the rim of the near circle. It went over the left shoulder of Pearson into the back of the net. And we're tied at two with 15:30 to go in the third period.
Carter Mazur, man, he is something special. Ninth of the season now in eight games for him. Breaks the tie atop the national leaderboard in goals. He's now first overall. Innocent enough looking chance, but we talked about those rushes that Denver got in the first period to stretch it from your own zone. And Mazur with a clean look on net, snuck it under the right arm of Ludwig Pearson.
Just simple room to skate. Red Hawk defenders were too separated from him in the zone. And he fired it right in on Pearson. Nice snipe. So we're tied at two. Different feel and vibe to this game early on in the third period. Red Hawks can't keep the puck in the offensive zone. Another break for Denver. Lorenz over the Red Hawk line right wing. A shot goes off the blade of Donato's stick. He was the defender back. Up and out of play in the far corner with 15:02 to go in period number three. And the draw to Ludwig's left is coming up out of the stoppage. Pioneers on a season-long three-game winning streak, trying to grow it to four here tonight. RedHawks would like to get something out of their first league series of the year this evening as well. So you got Helin and Ozar in this draw to the left of Pearson in the RedHawks zone. Clean win in the circle for Miami. Helin to Taransky up the right wing for Ryan Savage. Pops it over the Pioneer line right wing to the far corner of the Denver zone. Here's Behrens with it far half wall. Work back to the right point. Taransky on it for Miami. Walks down the far half wall. Break wide top of the near circle is Rehquist. He will work it down below the goal line. Picked up by Helin. Swings it around the far post. Went off the left pad there of Krona. Back up behind the zone on the far wing. Kept in by Taransky. Now Rick wide, Ryan Savage in front. Got tripped up by Krona. They're not going to call it. Incidental contact there. Pioneers through center ice. Mayhew over the Red Hawk line right wing for Wright, who will shoot it. Nice block by Rehquist back in the play with the left leg. Goes to the far corner. Kumlin up the right wing boards for Ryan Savage. Gets to the center ice red line right wing and spins it around to the near corner. Mayhew's on it. Messenberg closes in on him. Ozar right side. He will flip this one all the way down the ice in the Red Hawk zone. Lemire picks it up in the far corner. No icing. Lemire to the near corner of the offensive zone for Denver. Takes it behind the net. Far circle. A shot there that was blocked in traffic coming in for the one-timer for Denver was Bouillon. Here come the Redhawks. Over the Denver line left wing is Daskus. Takes it in behind the Pioneer net to the far circle. Spin around play in front. Loose puck popped over a couple sticks in the area for Miami. And Lemire will spin it in on Pearson's net from the center ice red line left wing. Clement, the only one back, picks it up. Fires up the left wing boards, a feed there that missed everybody but deflected away for an icing, or no icing I should say. Redhawks far wing will work it all the way back in their own end from the offensive zone. Rehquist gets to the red line center ice right wing, pumps it around the boards to the near corner. Red Savage picks it up to the near side for Fletcher. Grabbing it there was Caragiallo right points and a weak one wide left of the net. Red Savage now works it to the near corner of the Denver zone. Olvestad up the right wing boards trying to get it out with help from Dornbach, could not. Little battle ensues near half wall here in the Denver zone. Back to the left point, Donato shoots it in wide to the far side of the net of Krona. Rizzo picks up loose puck far half wall. Denver over the Red Hawk line left wing. Rizzo far circle driving toward the net, hands it off to Mazur, swings his way to the far half wall. Carter Mazur for Rizzo. Center point, room to skate, far circle. Rizzo, a dangle move, a pass in front. Tripped up was Dornbach. The arms go up. A power play is coming to Denver as the Redhawks touch it up behind their own net. He had a far circle feed from Rizzo going in front of the net to Dornbach, who was tripped up as the feed came his way. He fell over, and Nick Donato is to the box. 2 minutes for what I'll assume is tripping here with 12:29 to go in period number three. And to beg your pardon, it's interference against Donato. So Denver to a major power play. Well, not a major power play, but a big power play, I should say, coming up next with 12:29 to go in the third. We get a timeout. 2-2 game. This is Miami Hockey on Red Hawk Radio. Well, 29 to go, third period, a power play for Denver as we come out of the break in a 2-2 game. Draw to the right of Ludwig Pearson is coming up. It'll feature Joey Cassetti up against Denver's number 13, Massimo Rizzo. Pioneers won the faceoff. A Denver power play tonight that is 0-3. And they'll cough it up in the offensive zone. The puck off Missouri's skate back to center ice. With 1:46 to go in the power play for Denver, and the Pioneers regroup with the Red Hawk line here on the left wing. Goes in behind the net, Missouri far half wall, grabbing it as Rizzo back to the left point here for a feed to Dornbach. Top of the far circle, Rizzo walks in, shoots it. Nice pass saved by Pearson, pops it front Missouri. Trying to whack at it, but Ludwig had it covered. And they blow the play dead here with 1:30 to go in the power play for Denver. 11:58 left in the third as Pearson there had it covered on the far post. Players are locked up after the whistle in front of the Red Hawk net. Linesman will help in separating that. And we stay tied at two with the draw coming to Ludwig's right coming up. 90 seconds to go in the power play for Denver. A big power play at that.
Yeah, and Denver's clamping down really hard like we saw them do on that last power play. They're going to bring those guys down in front of the net. And they're really hacking and whacking in front of Ludwig Pearson.
Clean win to the left point for Denver. Benning, though, popped it off his stick. Red Hawks trying to feed ahead to Red Savage. Benning, though, a good defensive play to stick him away from the puck at the Pioneer line. But we have tripped up by Fletcher coming out of his own zone, and you got to call it. It's going to be a 5-on-3 for Denver for a minute 13 with 11:42 to go in the third as P.J. Fletcher gets a stick in the legs of the Denver player trying to carry the puck up the ice from behind his own net. And the Pioneers with a golden opportunity. The red carpet rolled out to take the lead. A 1 minute, 12 second, 5-on-3 coming their way in the middle stages of the third.
It's one of those tough plays, like you said, Patrick, where you got to call it. Fletcher just kind of whacked on the legs of the defender there, and he goes down, and you got to call that trip. Miami a little discombobulated as they had nobody going to take the face off. But this is going to be a tough task for this penalty kill.
Barbellini, Moulton, and Clement are out there for the Red Hawks. They cannot clear after a faceoff win to start it up. But William with it for Denver. Pioneers scored a 5-on-3 goal last night. Right point, Dornbach gets it to the near corner there for Rizzo. Right point, Dornbach to Bowiem. Center point, Dornbach. Far circle, a drive went over the net. On a beautiful look there for Benning. A one-timer will carry him its way off the glass all the way back into the Denver zone. So Bowiem with it, 43 to go in the 5-on-3 tie for Denver. Over the Red Hawk line, left wing. Far circle, Rizzo drive to the net. He gets stick checked there from behind by Moulton. Good defensive play. The loose puck picked up by Red Savage. It will clear all the way down the ice. Goes far corner, Denver zone. 26 to go in 5-on-3 time. Missouri over the Red Hawk line here on the right wing. To the near circle. Centers it over there for Dornbach. Missed him. Went to the left point for Behrens. Walks it far half wall, left point Dornbach, up high in the zone, far circle, one timer, Missouri, Pearson slides over and makes the save with the right pad. It pops its way to the end boards, and the Red Hawks clear from there on a battle win as Red Savage worked it out back to center. 5-on-3 time is over, 48 second power play now for Denver. Over the Red Hawk line to the right wing, high slot, throws a shot, ripped it over the net on the right side. Rebound comes to the near corner. Pioneers work it up to the right point. Dornbach slides it over for Lorenz. 33 to go in the power play for the Pioneers. Near corner now. It's sent up to the line for Dornbach. Left point Behrens shoots it. Far circle. A shot tipped it on Pearson. And he makes the save with the right pad stopping the puck. His glove covering it up in the blue paint against the far post. The clock stop with 10:05 to go in the third after the shot from the top of the far circle by Behrens. 24 to go in the Denver power play. And Ludwig will have the draw coming to his right here in the Red Hawk zone.
Really, really good job by Miami on that 5-on-3. Not out of the woods yet. Still 24 seconds to go on the kill. But the first piece of a 5-on-3, really, really job well done.
Denver loses the faceoff to the far corner. Moulton picks it up in his own zone. Banks it off the glass all the way down the ice. With 15 seconds to go in the power play here for the Pioneers. Behrens feeds it up on the near wing with the puck is Haskins. Left wing Devine over the Red Hawk line. Charges through the far circle. Backhand centering pass. Knocked down by Clement. Red Hawks grab control. Will get one final clear. And the power play is over. The Red Hawks kill the 5-on-3 with 9:35 to go in the third. We're all tied up at two. Here's Behrens. Left wing feed over the Red Hawk line. Coming down the wing is Bros in the far corner. Dishes up high, picked up by Ryan Savage. He'll skate it through the center circle over the Pioneer line here on the left wing. feeding it over, sorry, to Helene in the near corner. Behrens picks it up off the glass back to center ice. You got Rehquist back with it in his own end for the Redhawks. Spins it off the end boards for Denver here in the neutral zone. Lemire sends it ahead back to the Redhawks in their own zone as Denver in a change. Redhawks through center ice. Here's Taransky over the pioneer line left wing. Little shot high in the zone in on Trona. Easy glove save for him to make with the snapper. 8:55 is left in period number three. All tied up at two, Miami and Denver. They will jump around in Oxford. And this is Miami Hockey on Red Hawk Radio. .55 to go in the third period, all tied up at two between Miami and Denver. This one's going to come down to the wire. Patrick Geshan, Luke West, Poley back with you high above the ice at Steve Cady Arena. Zach Renger's with us as well tonight. It's going to be the team that makes the most mistakes in the last 9 minutes or so, Luke, that's going to lose the game.
Yep, we talked about mistakes. Talked about it throughout the game, capitalizing on mistakes. Both teams have done it on their goals. And it looks like the next mistake might be the difference in this one.
Draw to the right of Krona. Redhawks control. We're 5-on-5 out of the timeout. And a battle here in the near half wall on the Miami offensive end. It's got a lot of fireworks to it. Pretty physical last period or so in this game. Kumla gets the battle win for the Redhawks. Right point to Dotto. Sends a bullet wide to the near side of Krona's net. Goes to the near corner of the Miami offensive zone. Ryan Savage, the puck locked up against his skate in the boards. As they dig and fight for it down there, two against two, battle in front of the student section. Pioneers win it and get the puck back out to center. Lemire left wing. Here is a chip in over the Red Hawk line by Edwards. We get a whistle for a penalty. Yep. Hooking. Who's it on?
Coming out of the
Red
scrum, Hawk. It's going to be on Miami. And it's on Daskus, I believe. And right back to the kill.
Did you see it?
Yeah, it was coming out of the scrum there, and Daskus just kind of got tied up with a Denver player going behind the play.
All right.
It's another tough penalty for the Redhawks to take. Pioneers are going to use this almost as a mini timeout. They've done that a lot. I've really noticed that. They take a long time to get lined up. They don't line up until they absolutely have to. Give them credit. They're taking what they're getting right now. And right back to work for a power play that has struggled, but is certainly dangerous. We saw it last night.
Oh, yeah. Gerard Pearson's left ear is coming up. It'll be Red Savage against Dornbach. Red clean win back, and Moulton clears it down the ice. A Denver power play that is 0-for-5 on the night tonight. So they'll take it out of their own zone. Pioneers well. Here's Benning. Drops it back for Mazur. Through center ice. Right wing feed for Rizzo over the Red Hawk line. Dornbach. Back to the right point for Benning. Never got the feed. It was picked off by Red Savage, who carries it back to center ice. Here's Mazur over the Red Hawk line left wing. Gets it to the far corner. Clement first to the puck. Squeezed off there as the puck now in the near corner. Near circle, Rizzo sent a shot wide to the right of Pearson's net. 1:20 left, Denver power play. Far half ball with it is Bowiem. Off the boards to the left point for Benning. Right point, Rizzo, top the near circle. Watts it middle. Far circle now for Bowiem. Rink wide. Benning, too late for the one-timer. Slides the wraparound to the far post. Pearson made the stop with the right pad. Lucid behind the net. Mazur, near circle, Rizzo. Back to Mazur. Point blank. He scores! Roofed one, top right corner of the net. And it's 3-2 Denver with 56 seconds to go with a power play. They strike Carter Mazur, a five-goal weekend.
You can just feel it coming, Patrick. You can't take that many penalties against a power play like this. Miami gets caught with way too many guys down low, and it brings everybody down kind of along the goal line when the puck was behind their net. Found a soft spot where Carter Mazur could walk in. Got a point-blank opportunity on Ludvig Pearson, and he makes no mistake. And Denver will steal the lead here. Now Miami trailing for the first time tonight, in need of a response.
Mazur from Rizzo and Benning, 12:49 into period number three. We got 7:03 to go in the third. The Pioneers take the lead at 3-2. The Redhawks ice the puck after the center ice faceoff from their own zone. 6:58 to go in the third. Gerard Pearson's left is coming up. You're right, you can feel it coming. Mazur, you can't leave that guy wide open in front of your own net. He's going to do damage, and that's exactly what he did. Roofed a beautiful shot from right in front of Pearson in the top right corner of the net. Ludvig had no chance there. Clean one, Denver offensive zone. Edwards a shot. Pearson fights it off with the right shoulder on the snapper. Far corner, Donato picks it up for Miami in his own zone. Right wing feed, Rehnquist. Up ahead, Waldron. Rink wide to the near side of the ice. Cassetti picks it up over the line here on the left wing. Back for Donato. Towards center ice. Rehnquist picks it up. Far side in front of the Red Hawk bench. Sends it up the right wing. Chipped over the Pioneer line by Waldron. To the far half wall of the Denver zone. Lorenz up the far wing for Capone. Sends it back in the Red Hawk end for Clement. Denver a full five-man change. Probably see Denver go to some dump and chase stuff here. That's what they did last night about this time of the game. Ryan Savage over the Pioneer line on the right wing to the near corner for Lorenz. Banks it up the near half wall. Pops loose in the near circle. Barbellini with a puck in the near corner. Spins around to the near side boards. Hands it off for Kuma. Near circle, he's got it. The shot off the near post. Kind of deflected there by Krona. Now far side, Helene. Down to the far half wall. Pioneers will grab it in their own zone. Work it out back to center. Kuma, though, got a loose puck near side of the center. Ice red line banked it off the glass. In behind the net. Lee spins it around the boards. Lorenz back out to center. Kumlin to the near wing for Taranski. To center of the ice. Helene will grab it here and on net. The backhand just wide to the left side of the net as he got a little rush forward. Going to whistle for a penalty though behind the play. On Denver for hooking. It's going to be against Bros, who is back on defense there on the Helene chance. No, I'm sorry. Lee's going to get it. Their captain. He had Helene get a quick feed down the middle toward the Denver net. He had not a breakaway, but a break to the net. And he had Lee in on him, who made the hooking play on Helene as he was coming in toward Krona. Never really got a clean shot off. And the Redhawks a chance to tie it here with 5:35 to go in the third of the power play.
Lee just kind of got spun around there when the puck bounced off his stick.
Clean win, Red Savage back to the blue line for the Redhawks. Spun around the boards to the far half wall, right, Red Hawk power play. It's 1-for-3 on the night, by the way. Fletcher right point, sends it down to the far corner. Mayhew's on it, he'll grab it from the goal line area and get out the lob wedge to send it all the way down the ice. Rehnquist turned over in the Red Hawk zone in a battle with Wright, who's doing a great job on the PK forecheck, holding the puck away. Finally, Red Savage takes it away, spins it around the boards to Barbellini through center ice. He'll dish back to Rehnquist. Left wing now for Red Savage over the Pioneer line with room to skate. Flings it over on the far side to Ryan Savage. Right point Fletcher back for Ryan Savage in the far corner. Fletcher right point for Rehnquist center point. 1:12 to go on the power play. Top of the near circle for Red Savage. Down low the near corner for Ryan Savage. Now it's Red left point. Down low for Ryan. Back for Red left point. Right point now for Rehnquist. Far half wall here with it is Fletcher. Dances to the corner. Off the boards to the right point for Rehnquist. Down to the net, sends the puck. Picked up by Fletcher with a shot. And a great save for the far circle by Krona with a blocker. Far corner goes the puck. Red Savage crashes in with Behrens. And Denver's going to clear after it popped off their sticks all the way down the ice. 37 to go on the power play here for Miami.
See how disciplined Denver is in their kill. Miami's just passing the puck in circles right now, but they're not getting anything towards the net.
That's a good point. 4:02 to go in the third as well. Red Hawks through center. Taranski left wing, Cassetti over the Pioneer line. Dishes back to the left point. Here's Comlin. 18 to go on the power play for the Red Hawks. Waldron near corner, down low for Cassetti behind the net. Far circle with it. Taranski And his feed to the blue line was picked off by Devine, who will send it back to the Red Hawks zone. Coomlin will chase it down in behind the Red Hawk net. 2 seconds to go on the power play. It's over. We're back to 5-on-5. Denver with a huge kill. They're up 3-2 with 3.5 to go in the third period. Edwards spins around and banks it off the boards all the way down the ice from behind his own net for Denver. And that will be an easy icing call for the officials to make with 3:23 to go in period number three. Just keep in mind the Red Hawks have already used their timeout. They did so in the first period on an icing. Denver still has theirs. And the draw to Cronin's left is coming up here in the third. Daskus for Miami will go up against Denver's number four in Jack Devine. Clean one for the Pioneers to the far corner. Mayhew lifts it off glass, back into the Red Hawks zone. Clement is there to pick it up. Through center ice, he'll go. Lifted over the Pioneer line here on the left wing. Helene far half wall, kicked it in behind the net. Here's Daskus to the near corner. Flings it up to the left point for Dylan Moulton. Back down low for Daskus. Lost in near corner. Pioneers take control. Mazur banks it off the boards to center ice. Moulton turned it over again. Here's Rizzo over the Red Hawk line to the right wing. Through the near circle. Lost it through his feet. Picks up the puck though. Takes it to the far corner. Fed up to the left point for Behrens. Right point Benning. Down low for Mazur near circle. 2:43 to go in the third. 3-2 Denver. Swung around to the far half wall. Behrens chips it away there for Dornbach. Near circle, Mazur takes it in behind Pearson's net. Mazur, far circle on a tour in the zone. Feeds right point for Benning. Center blue line, Behrens. Plays it down to the slot. Picked off there by Helene. Red Hawks clear at the center. They'll get a full five-man change here as Behrens chases the puck back in his own zone for the Pioneers. 2:16 to go in the third. Play through center ice, Behrens. Over the left wing. Coomlin got a hold of it. Battle starts in front of the benches. Denver able to work it deep off the stick and the backhand there of Edwards in behind the Red Hawk net. And here corner Rehquist. Hits it below the goal line there for Coomlin. Far side Fletcher. Left wing feed over the Pioneer line. Trying to hit Barbellini, but the pass was 10 feet in front of him. And we'll go for an icing call here on Miami with 1:54 to go in period number three. Denver 3, Miami 2. And the draw to Pearson's left is coming up.
Denver still got that timeout. They've been playing that top line a lot as of late. They've had to because of how many power plays they've gotten, but I wouldn't be surprised to see them use it maybe if they give up an icing here in the later goings, but it's time for Miami to get this one into the ozone.
Cleanwood near corner. Rehquist gets it out to center for Fletcher, and this one goes in the Red Hawk bench here. For a stoppage up the right wing with 1:47 left in period number three. They're going to move the faceoff to the neutral zone on the Red Hawk right wing closest to their blue line. That faceoff features Joey Cassetti up against Denver's number two in, or 22 rather, in Connor Capone. Cleanwood Red Hawks back in their own zone. Fans here on the edge of their seats at Steve Cady Arena. Want to see their Red Hawks get something out of this weekend series with Denver. And this one, another puck that pops in the Red Hawk bench up the right wing with 1:36 to go in period number three. And then face off again in the neutral zone. Miami trying to work it up the right wing out of their own zone again, but it popped up into the bench. And you will get a face off here between Rizzo and Cassetti. Cleanwood Rizzo. Pioneers a little bit of trouble controlling it at center ice. Back to the Red Hawks it goes. Rehquist near wing with less than 90 seconds to go in the third. They're gonna pull Ludvig Pearson now with a puck at center ice. Coomlin puts it deep in the Denver zone. Empty net Miami down 3-2, 1:18 to go in the third. Pioneers bank it off the glass to center ice. Far wing, it's sent toward the empty net and into it from the benches by Rizzo. On the left wing, a simple dump in with room from center ice. He flung it toward the empty net. It went in, and with a 1:12 to go in the third period, Massimo Rizzo makes it 4-2 Denver after the Pearson pull. Pioneers with a 2-goal lead.
Yeah, just not great awareness on the ice from all five guys that were originally out there for Miami. Didn't really look like any of them knew that Ludvig Pearson had been pulled, or else they would have pressured that puck a little higher. I mean, they let Rizzo just skate that puck in towards the edge of the zone, and he's not going to miss a wide open net from the blue line.
No. Redhawks here at center ice, put it deep into the Denver zone. Barron's hit hard there by Red Savage. Mayhew's on it. Back to the near half wall, sent out back to center. Clement on it there for the Redhawks. Worked it down to the near half wall. Mayhew banks it off the boards to the right wing of center ice. Haskins there tied up with Moulton. Redhawks back with it in their own zone. 45 to go, third period. Red Savage right wing of center ice, puts it far corner of the Denver zone. Crona lets it go behind him. Fletcher picks it up near corner here for the Redhawks. Spins it around the boards in behind the net. Barbellini there, get tied up with Behrens. Pioneers work it out for the near corner. Up the right wing for Ozark. Passes middle here for over the Redhawk line on the right wing. A feed to Lorenz will put it behind Pearson. 20 seconds to go in the third period. Drasner behind the net. Here's Rehquist through the near circle. Left wing feed Barbellini over the Pioneer line here on the left side. Put it to the near corner, will chase after the puck. Bowiem and Lee tie up for it there. Now it's Helene. Up to the left point for Rehquist. Dances down low to the near half wall. Hampus Rehquist near corner trying to fling it in on Lee, and that will do it. You got a fight going on inside the Denver net at the buzzer. And a little bit of pushing and shoving after the play. Rehquist trying to shove Crona.
Couple and sweets.
Waldron was tied up inside the Denver net, literally inside of it, with number 22 for the Pioneers at Capone.
This series got uncharacteristically chippy.
Oh yeah.
Denver's not normally a team you think of as super physical and super imposing, but here on this Saturday, that was kind of the game they played at times.
Yeah. So anyway, the Pioneers win the game 4-2 over Miami. The Redhawks drop both in their first league series of the year on their home ice. As Denver comes in and gets the sweep, a huge sweep for the Pioneers to get their league slate started. For the Redhawks, Luke, bottom line, signs of positive things tonight, signs of effort. Good things came for Miami at times in this game, but at the end of the day, the Redhawks just did not have the firepower to match the third-ranked team in the nation. That's what it came down to.
Yep, and you got to stay out of the box.
Yep.
Right? You can't you can't take seven penalties in game and expect to win. You said it well. It came down to really just a matter of talent. If you don't take those seven penalties, if you your penalty kill, you can't fault it really for giving up a goal later on in this one. I mean, 6 for 7 on the penalty kill in a night it's really, really good. And you hate to give up a goal at any time, but when you look at it from that perspective, it certainly doesn't seem as bad. Like you said, it really just felt like they were overmatched in that third period. It felt like we hadn't seen Denver's best hockey. You said it off air. It felt like there was kind of something that we were waiting to see out of that Denver team that we hadn't quite seen yet tonight, that we certainly got to see yesterday. And I think Denver really brought it in that third period. They came away with a much-deserved win,
yep.
Much-deserved sweep. You see the shots have starting to open up a little bit more towards the end of that third period, and they ended up in Denver's favor as they doubled up Miami over that 42-20.
Right.
But yeah, overall, it just looked like a better Denver team in the third. That was what it came down to. They scored 3 unanswered, including the empty netter. And it's tough, but that's the NCHC. It's going to be like this every week for Miami for pretty much the rest of the season.
And it only gets better next week when they go to Western Michigan.
That'll be fun.
That will
Lawson Ice Arena.
Luke and I back in a moment to break down the game, but we get the postgame show started. Here's Zach Renger. Zach.
Thank you, Patrick. Obviously not the ending that the Redhawks were looking for. Just kind of ran out of gas at the end of that one. Ate a couple penalties. They spent way too much time in the box. We finally saw a man-up goal from Denver. It was about time. You kind of felt that coming. We heard Luke say it. You can't take that many penalties and expect to win a game. Obviously, let's look at the final stats from this one. Denver wins it 4-2. Obviously, asterisks next to that 4. It was an open net goal, so you're going to feel like that's probably going to be really 3-2, obviously, in terms of how it really felt. There were 7 assists for Denver, 2 Miami's 3, and this is where the beatdown really got going, and you're surprised when you look at these stats that Miami hung in this game as long as they did. Obviously, shots on goal, a huge stat for this sport, just showing how dominant Denver really was. 42 shots on goal compared to Miami's 20. You're not going to win with that. And 67 shots to Miami's 42 overall. There was 1 power play goal from each side. Obviously, the power play goal that we saw from Denver late in the game was the difference there. Power plays both 1-6 for Denver, 1-4 for Miami. Penalties, 7 penalties for Miami, 4 for Denver. And faceoffs were actually even, actually won by the Redhawks at 33-30. So one silver lining for the weekend, the Redhawks did win faceoffs in both those games. And the blocks, 14 for Miami, 12 for Denver, makes sense. Denver had a lot more shots today. And 12 penalty minutes to Denver's 8 for Miami. So that'll just about wrap up kind of the stat breakdown for the postgame show. I'll send it back over to Patrick and Luke for their final thoughts on this game.
Well, Zach, you can be a part of this too because you watched the game. 4-2 winners were Denver. At the end of the day, this was a much better performance, I think, guys, than what we saw last night from Miami. I know you guys weren't here, but in my view, this was much better than what the Redhawks showed us last night. But at the end of the day, it's the what my dad says, it's true, the horses in the race. Denver had better horses in the race than the Redhawks did tonight. That was plain and simple. And Denver, at the end of the day, made the more skilled plays, the better plays to win the game than the Redhawks did when they needed to.
Yeah, and it really feels odd in a game that had as many different twists and turns as it did and as much energy as it did to have it be that cut and dry, but it really was when you look back on it. And as you especially look at that third period, I mean, it was even throughout, but at the end of the day, it was just execution by a really good hockey team with a lot of good players on it. I mean, Carter Mazur was unbelievable this weekend. I mean, there's no other way really to put it. He had 5 goals on the weekend, and, you know, you can say your coach speak about how you can combat that and how you, you know, need to play better, but there are just so many dynamic threats on this Denver team. He, of course, kind of leads the charge for them offensively, but, yeah, you talk about the horses in the race. I mean, some of these guys are some of the more talented people in all of college hockey, and I think that was certainly evident in that third period. You can play your best game, and sometimes you'll just come up short. And I don't even think we really saw Denver's best game, to be honest.
Well,
we talked about it. We certainly didn't play very well at all today.
No.
I mean, Denver's a team. We talked about how offensively gifted they are, and yet they get 42 shots and only score 4 goals, and they get 7 power play opportunities and only score once.
Yeah.
I mean, Denver's best game is looking at least maybe 6, 7, maybe even 8 goals in this game if they're playing their best game out there, and I don't even think we saw that tonight. So it's just a really good hockey team that Denver has. They're going to compete for a national championship again this year like they have every single year in recent memory. But, yeah, you talk about the horses in the race. That's just a really, really good hockey team that came in this weekend and did what they needed to do to win a couple games.
Yeah, and I think, Luke, you make a great point there is that that's obviously not Denver's best game. Their best day is far ahead of them. We saw, you look at the stats like we broke down, I mean, they were dominant in terms of the stat categories. And to think that Miami was holding a lead all the way into the third quarter, trying to hold on for that win, you just got to think that, man, this Denver team could be really scary going down the stretch once they start to figure out these things. And obviously, Mazur, I think he's going to be in the running for player of the year. We saw him just domination. You can't put him one-on-one, even against one of the better goalies in the league.
Right.
Still gets one-on-one goals there, able to finish off those plays. And he was the difference tonight. He's been the difference all weekend. And that's the biggest thing for Denver. And he's going to be just the best horse in the race, per se, in national hockey.
The 10 goals now this season for Carter Mazur. It's nuts
at this point here. He could score a couple more goals, and then he could just stop playing and not score for a while, and he'd still be averaging a goal a game, right? Not even a point per game type of player. He's a goal per game type of player. That top line for Denver is, I mean, we saw it. They are just so good the way they get into the zone, they fly, and sometimes you don't even really notice it. And I would notice sometimes you get a whistle, and then you just kind of look up, and you'd see all 3 guys come off the ice, and you realize, oh wait, they just spent the last minute and a half in Miami zone, and we kind of picked up on it, but maybe we didn't always. It seemed like every time they were on the ice, good things were happening for Denver. That top line is really, really scary, and that all starts with Mazur. Zach said he might be player of the year, maybe in the conference, but, you know, this is a Denver team that has a guy in the Hobie Baker race every single year. He might be their guy this season.
For real. This guy's next level stuff. Carter Mazur, the Detroit draft pick, third-round pick from the Wings in 2021. And, just crazy stuff from this guy who, in 48 games played, has 48 career points coming into the game today. So he already has more points than games played in his college career.
And he won a national championship as a freshman.
Yeah. So I mean, there you have
that's,
it.
That's as ideal as you can get.
He's got it made. RedHawks, let's talk about them a little bit. We saw a really good first period, I thought, for Miami tonight. Second period, third period were okay. They were better than last night's second and third period. But at the end of the day, Luke, you said at the end when we sent it back to Zach, penalties were a big part of what the RedHawks killed them tonight. So number one, moving forward, you got to stay out of the penalty box. But number two for the RedHawks, kind of these stretches of 2 or 3 minutes where the communication is inconsistent, the execution is inconsistent, when this team looks very... The word you used tonight was discombobulated. That's been a trend Miami has shown over the last few years. They play decently, and then they have these 2 or 3 minute stretches where it all falls apart. Then they find it again. They've got to figure out a way to get these 2 to 3 minute stretches to not happen. But at the end of the day, for this RedHawks team, what do you think moving forward? Penalties, I think, is one, and then number two, just consistency of play. But what do you guys think?
Yeah, I think consistency of play is certainly one of them. But also, I think... developing a better offensive identity could be something that this team could improve on a little bit in the future. They got a lot of talent. We see that. I mean, there are some guys that it's really hard to describe, but just watching them play, you know that they're offensively gifted, and then you look at the stat sheet, and they don't really have a whole lot to show for it. And I think that also carried over into this game. I mean, Miami's first goal, you know, it's fortunate. It's not a goal. You know, you're never going to throw away goals. You're never going to say they're bad goals necessarily, but it comes because a Denver player blows a tire and you go the other way on a rush chance.
Yep.
And on the second opportunity, it's a broken play on a power play, and you end up scoring on it. So, you know, you take the goals when you can get them, but I don't think Chris Bergeron's going to look at this game and this weekend, because they didn't score any goals last night, and really look at a goal that they scored and say that was a good play all around from playing the system, working in the offensive zone, and really doing something that they liked. I think it was just a couple of plays really lining up for them nicely. And you got to be opportunistic, and we talked about that, but I think that only will take you so far. There are games like this where you'll get a couple opportunities and you'll score, but are 2 goals going to win you every game? Probably not. You're going to need to develop a little bit more prowess offensively in terms of setting up in the offensive zone and doing a little more. You could kind of take a little bit from Denver's game in that they're able – you look at what they do in the offensive zone and how they cycle and how they're able to get chances from across the ice, and they're really able to develop more danger when they get set up in the offensive zone. And I really thought when Miami got into the zone, there really just wasn't a whole lot that they generated in terms of high-quality chances. So I think that's something you could also point towards looking forward.
Yeah, and I think going down the stretch too, Luke, obviously the offensive identity is not there yet for this team. They're still figuring that out, trying to find the best way to use both the Savages. I mean, you got players. You got guys. You just got to figure out how to use them a little better, and you're absolutely right. The stats are not reflecting how good these guys actually are. But I think the main thing in this game, they got outlasted by Denver. That we saw the passes got sloppy, the getting back in time, not picking up the right guy on defense, that really became an issue down the stretch for Miami once we got about halfway through that third period. And we saw Denver. Obviously, this is a team. They're very deep, so take it with a grain of salt, because they're going to have fresh legs all the time and really good ones at that. But nonetheless, you would like to see Miami be a little bit better at keeping their stamina all the way through the game, being able to finish games like that, because we saw it. It got flat at the end of it. Things started hitting the fan that shouldn't really, and that was kind of the issue going down the stretch.
Yep, I couldn't agree more.
Yep.
All right, final thoughts before we wrap it up. RedHawks to Western Michigan next weekend, Friday and Saturday from Kalamazoo. That's going to be another tough one. It's not an easy place to play there in front of the old lunatics at Lawson Ice Arena. Loud. It's a barn. They like their Broncos up in Kalamazoo on the western part of the Mitten. So tough stuff for the RedHawks coming up.
That's a great
final thoughts.
That's a great place, isn't it? Western Michigan right now trailing Michigan in their series 4-2 here on a Saturday. Western Michigan, kind of the scary thing about them is they've been one of the more inconsistent teams in the NCHC. Not in that they're inconsistently bad, but it's just been up and down. Their top performance is really, really good, and their worst performance is not very good. They lost to Anchorage earlier this year. That's, you know, now a first-year program. That's not a good loss. That's not going to look good on your resume, but they've got some good wins as well. We saw last year possibly one of the best Western teams ever. That team was really, really talented. They lost some key pieces from that squad, but they're always really, really good. And like you said, Patrick, Lawson is a really, really tough place to play. It's compact. It's small. The student atmosphere may be the best in the NCHC
it's
with
awesome.
The Lunatics.
I love it.
It's a pretty cool place to play if you're at home, but pretty intimidating if you're the road team. I'm really excited to see also how a lot of these freshmen and sophomores, kind of the underclassmen for Miami, play in that environment, because the Tsongas Center was kind of empty, and I don't think the atmosphere at the Harbor Center was quite the same. This will be the first really big test on the road in terms of an intimidating environment that Miami has to go into next week. So really excited to see the response. But that's a series where Miami could really think about winning some games. I mean, it's not a bad Western team by any means. They're a good team, but they're definitely not a team like Denver where you go into the series thinking there's a big possibility where you lose them both. I think you go into that series next week, and if you can get a split and if you can look somewhat competitive in both of those games, I think you got to be really happy with how you come away on the road. So I think that might be the goal. Maybe you go in, try to steal a game on Friday, and then just see what happens in the Saturday game next weekend.
Yeah, and I couldn't agree more, Luke. Obviously, this is a team that's been tested on the road. Only the fourth game at home here in Goggin this year for Miami. Obviously, you kind of like that because that means down the stretch in the season when those kind of winter nights are getting longer, you have a lot more home games.
Yeah.
But they've been tested on the road. They've been road warriors to this point. I love that strategy. Let's steal a game on Friday, get to Saturday, and just see what happens. I mean, you got to play a confident game against those guys. Expect to win at least one, try to get two, and that's all you can do when you go up to Kalamazoo.
Right. I agree. 7 o'clock on Friday, 7 o'clock on Saturday from Lawson Ice Arena for Miami. Denver back home. They will play the Huskies of St. Cloud State Friday at 7 o'clock Mountain Time at Magnus Arena. Saturday, 6 o'clock Mountain Time at Magnus for Denver against the Huskies of St. Cloud State. All right, so that'll do it for us here tonight. The RedHawks fall in both games of the series. Denver improves to 6-2-0 on the year. They're 2-0-0 in the NCHC. The RedHawks are now 4-3-0 on the season, 0-2-0 to start out league play for Miami this weekend here from Steve Cady Arena. So, Zach, great job today. It was a pleasure to bring you on to hockey. Hope you enjoyed your first hockey game.
Yeah, it was certainly a change. I talked to you guys in one of the breaks as a former baseball player and always called baseball. This is completely out of my league, but it was a lot of fun. It certainly had me on the edge of my seat.
Well, you did a great job. Thanks for coming. Luke, good job as always.
Thank you, sir.
And looking forward to future broadcasts with both of you as we move down throughout the rest of the year. We got hoops starting soon, hockey's going, football's wrapping up.
Action.
Before you know it, it's going to be baseball season. So
football's wrapping up. We got the most fun part of the season coming up, though.
What's that?
That's some action.
45 degrees
election
out there.
Election night.
With my hand warmers.
30 degrees, windy, snowy.
All right.
You name it.
Hashtag Maction.
Yes, sir.
All right. 4-2 the final tonight here from Denver. For Zach Rengers, Luke West Poley, everybody else that makes it possible behind the scenes, Patrick Geshan saying so long and good night. From Steve Cady Arena in Oxford, thanks for listening to this presentation of Miami Hockey on Red Hawk Radio. Red Hawks fall tonight, 4-2 your final. We'll see everybody later. Good night.